you want to
put? Evening, everyone. We're on the record.
Maximum 15 years.
Meeting has begun. Today is Wednesday. This is a regular meeting of the Jersey City Municipal Council. Today is Wednesday, the 27th day of January in the year 2016. Before he departs, I'd like to thank my deputy, Sean Gallagher, for filling in for me during my recovery. We had a 6 p.m. scheduled start. It is now, per my watch, 6:16. From my phone, I should say, which I hope you will all silence your phones. Council Please. President, I'm going to call the roll. Councilperson Gajewski, Ram Chow, Bagiano, Yun, Osborne,
Should be here late.
Holman, Rivera,
Step away.
Waterman,
here.
Lavaro,
here.
Would everyone kindly rise to observe a moment of silence? Council members, first reading ordinances. I'll read their titles into the record, but before I do that, I would like to have a motion from the council to add resolutions 10Z2 through 10Z4 to the agenda tonight.
Motion.
We have a motion. Let me record you present, Councilman Rivera. At 6:17, we're still missing Councilperson Osborne. So we have a motion by to add resolutions 10Z2 through 10Z4 to the agenda. And can we make this a compound motion? Because I know the young people are here, and we're going to go right to that, Council President. Am I correct?
Yes.
So we'll make it a compound motion and to defer to those items. Is that, would that be the form of your motion, Councilperson Waterman and Councilman Rivera?
That's a yes.
Add them and defer to the items. On the motion, Councilperson Gajewski.
Yeah.
Ram Chow?
Aye.
Bagiano?
Aye.
Yun?
Aye. I can pull it. I can pull it. Yeah.
And it's I can't pull
Councilperson
it.
Councilperson Osborne right. is present. Will more. Oh, sorry.
Yeah, sure.
She's absent. Yeah. Councilperson Coleman?
What are you talking about?
Rivera?
Here.
Waterman?
Oh, I see the resolutions.
Waterman?
Yes. Aye.
Council President?
Aye.
Motion carries 8-0. So we've added those items into the record. And we are going to defer to 10Z2, 10Z3, and 10Z4. Who's going to do the pleasure of reading them into the record? Council President?
Excuse me?
Are you going to read them into the record, sir?
Sure. Let's start with a resolution congratulating Kyla Holmes on being elected deputy mayor of Reverend Dr. Ursel Webb School. We have three resolutions. Actually, how do you want to do this? You want me to read all three into the record? Yeah?
I think we could read one and then name the other two people and indicate there.
Okay.
But they were elected too.
So I will read into the record the resolution congratulating Michael Cruz on being elected mayor of Reverend Dr. Ursel Webb School, PS 22. Whereas the Reverend Dr. Ursel F. Webb School, also known as PS 22, is a public school in Jersey City, New Jersey, which is dedicated to the education of children in kindergarten through fifth grade. And whereas understanding the need for civic engagement and student representation within the administrative leadership of the school An election was held to select the mayor of PS-22, and whereas the mayoral candidates were selected through the primary elections within each fifth grade homeroom class, and Michael Cruz won the nomination of his peers in Ms. Figueroa's class, and whereas to help the campaign, Michael Cruz and his campaign team in Ms. Figueroa's class were assigned a political facilitator, the Assemblywoman Angela McKnight, and adopted the slogan, "Michael's the best, forget the rest." Whereas after a very active week-long campaign, a school-wide election was held on Friday, December 18th, 2015, and Michael Cruz was elected by his schoolmates as mayor of PS-22. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Municipal Council of the City of Jersey City does hereby commend Michael Cruz for being elected mayor of PS-22 and wishes him lots of luck in his term as chief executive of the student body. And we have similar resolutions for the other two candidates who were ultimately elected to deputy mayor of PS-22, and that would be Kyla Holmes and Jocelyn Nunez.
Council members, we're going to vote on all the resolutions in one group, so it's 10Z2 through 10Z4.
Actually, before we vote, can we bring the students up along with their teachers and political facilitators? And their parents, if they're here too, if they want to join them, that's fine. And the City Council is going to cast its votes, and then you'll have an opportunity to share a few words. Each of you will have that opportunity. And okay, Robert, you want to call for the vote?
Okay. Let me do that, Council President. Councilperson Gajewski. Councilperson Ramchal.
Jocelyn, I know you put up a good fight. Great job. Michael, congratulations, man. You did it well. You did it Obama style. Thank you. With that being said, I wish you guys good luck. And Michael, I hope you bring better pizza to the school, all right? Good. Good luck. Congratulations.
Kyla.
And Kyla as well, you know. Work with Michael. I think you guys are going to get a lot accomplished in the school as deputy mayor. Good luck. With that, I vote aye.
Okay. Thank you. Councilman Bargiano.
Congratulations, and I vote aye.
Councilperson Yun.
Congratulations. You got thankless job. I'm telling you. Whatever you do, the people say something, you know. But
got Angela, don't worry.
You know what? To be you know, mayor and deputy mayor, you gotta honest to your strength, to your friends, and I want you guys to stand up for the strength for your school, okay? And good luck. I vote for aye.
Okay, Councilperson Osborne is absent. Councilperson Coleman?
Stepped away.
Councilperson Rivera?
Congratulations to all three. Congratulations to your parents as well for doing such a great job. Teachers at the school, administrators, congratulations. You did a well job with this, and I vote aye.
Councilperson Waterman.
Congratulations, and you're about to embark on a joyous journey. So often politics get a bad name, but it's really a joyous journey. And I know when you go to school, you're going to represent your school well, and you're going to fight for what's right for the children in school. So once again, congratulations, and enjoy the journey. It's a good journey.
I vote aye.
Council President?
Let me start. Kyla, I didn't get to see much, but I saw you at the final gathering and when you gave your speech, and you were awesome. I'm expecting big things from you, not just as deputy mayor, but moving forward beyond that. I think you're a spectacular presenter and speaker. And Mr. Holmes, you've got a great daughter there. Michael, congratulations. I am Jocelyn's political facilitator, so I was rooting for my girl Jocelyn, but you definitely put together a great campaign, and begrudgingly I will acknowledge that the assemblywoman really turned it up, had you on beast mode, as she said, and you did a great job, spectacular campaign. You had the whole school rocking to Michael Cruz and your slogan, and Mom, you did a great job, and you should be very proud. And while Michael's the mayor, I'm going to save my final words for Jocelyn. I'm so proud of you, Jocelyn. You're just awesome. You did a great job, and I think maybe you started the whole thing as the underdog, but I think you definitely put on just a great campaign, was out there into the entire school, sharing yourself and telling people what your slogan and your vision was, the great pizza, outdoor recreation and recess. And what was the third one?
Okay, and your vote is aye. We have a 7-0 vote for the approval of the resolution.
So I vote aye. And congratulations to all of you. Do a great job. Thank you.
Okay.
Name Jeremy.
Is there any, how about the new mayor come forward and say a few words?
Oh, yeah, I think each of them are going to come up.
Yeah.
So why don't we start with, let Michael go last as the mayor, right? And Kyla, as deputy mayor, would you like to start?
Good evening. Sorry. Good evening, Council President Lavaro, honorable council members, representative of the Corporation Counselor's Office, invited guests, and those in attendance. My name is Kyla Holmes, and I'm one of the deputy mayors at PS22. I'd like to thank you for inviting us to this meeting to address all of you. I would like to say that it was such an amazing experience to run for mayor of PS22. Mr. Platt shared so many strategies to use throughout the election process. I really thought that our campaign slogan, Keep Calm and Vote for Kyla, was really cool and would help me most when I was under pressure during the campaign. Reminded me to keep calm when I was standing at the podium, nervous and speaking to the entire school. The campaign made me work harder to build upon ideas for the school and come together with our mayor, Michael, and Jocelyn, our other deputy mayor. This experience has also made me more confident to accomplish whatever I set my mind to, such as standing up for what my fellow peers feel is important to make our school even better. I've learned the importance of being a leader, not a follower. Leaders get the job done. I couldn't have asked for a better campaign team, security detail, and most of all, my advertising team. Without them, I am not sure the whole school would have even known who I was. We are looking forward to see all the wonderful things Michael and the rest of the team can work towards for the remainder of the year. We hope that we can look to you for leadership and guidance in the future, because we look up to you to make the city better. We are the future.
Thank you.
Good evening, City Council President Lavaro, honorable council members, representatives of the corporation's counselor's office, invited guests, and those in attendance. My name is Jocelyn Muniz, as some of you may know, and I am one of my school PS22's deputy mayors. I wanted to address you, the City Council, on the great experience I had running for mayor. During the process, I learned how to speak up and be the voice for my fellow peers, listen to the concerns and the things they would like to change. I would like to take the time out to thank all of the city councilmen and women who endorsed me for mayor. They supported and believed in me and what I stand for. I would especially like to thank Council President Lavaro. You made my campaign one of the most memorable moments of the school year. You went above and beyond your role as mentor by dressing as Santa Claus and handing out candy canes to the younger students. Also, walking with me class by class to hand deliver pizzas to every student. You taught me so much in a few weeks, even so much that I could run against you one day.
Yes.
Thank you all again for allowing me to address you and share the wonderful experience I've had. And I promise to you all that I will hold my deputy mayor position with pride. Have a good evening.
Good evening. Good evening, Council President Lavaro, honorable council members, representatives of the Corporation Counselor's Office, invited guests, and those in attendance. My name is Michael Cruz, and thank you for inviting us to the City Hall. Before I reflect on experiences and everything I learned, I would like to personally thank Ms. McKnight for guiding me and my class and sharing her extensive experience in running a campaign. I learned the importance of teamwork. She helped us organize into three groups. We had the platform committee, which was responsible for managing and organizing the music, classroom speech schedule, and creating a political poster message that would be effective. This committee consisted of organizers in each one of those areas. We had a separate committee for the vast amount of posters and poster cards used to get out the message. We had a third committee. We had a third committee with an organizer that was responsible for distributing all of this material. And this freed me up so that I could write and work on the presentation of my campaign speech. Mentioning the platform speech, I learned about the importance of the platform speech and how to create an effective, positive speech that would excite the voters. I learned how to approach voters throughout the halls of the school and find out what change they wanted to see in our school. The overall experience was a rewarding one. I feel that my class and I learned so much from this experience. I am very thankful from the team support my class, Ms. McKnight, and last but not the least, my teacher, Ms. Figueroa. During campaign, I'm not only learned how to present a speech, but I also learned the leadership skills that a leader should have. The importance of greeting and keep reminding the students, don't forget to vote. Most of all, staying confident and carrying a positive belief that will take you towards your goal. Once again, I would like to thank all those involved in helping my campaign, my learning experience, and the invitation to be here today. Also, thank you, Chico, for telling me that I would win mayor, because I did win mayor.
Hey, Michael, don't worry. You're going to work with me in my campaign next. Don't worry. You'll be my campaign manager.
Yeah, I'm going to come and get him, too. I'm going to come and get you, too.
Right. I think you are the back.
So where's Corporations Counselor Mr. Farrell?
Oh,
he swore in the mayor.
Oh wow!
Well, I didn't want him to feel bad. He had lost last year's election, so.
Rover Montgomery. Is there anyone parked on Grove Street between Columbus? No, on Grove and Montgomery. On Grove between Columbus and Montgomery, they're doing snow removal. Please move your vehicle if it's you.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thanks a lot, man. It's good to be great. Let's
get this meeting started. Council members, I'm going to read the first reading ordinances into the record.
Yes, go ahead.
Some time. 3A, City Ordinance 16013, an ordinance authorizing the execution of a right-of-way use agreement between the City of Jersey City and New York SMSA Limited Partnership, doing business as Verizon Wireless, to permit the installation of antennas and related communications equipment on existing utility poles, and if necessary, to install utility poles within a certain public rights of way for purposes of providing telecommunication services. Three B, City Ordinance 16014, is an ordinance of the Municipal Council of the City of Jersey City adopting amendments to the Journal Square 2060 redevelopment plan, creating a new Zone 12 and bonus incentives for office space. 3C, City Ordinance 16015, an ordinance of the Municipal Council of the City of Jersey City adopting amendments to the Water Street redevelopment plan to incentivize affordable housing. 3D, City Ordinance 16016, an ordinance authorizing the City of Jersey City to lease city-owned property known as Block 28201, lots 10 and 12 through 16, also known as Ralph Taylor Memorial Park, to the Jersey City Public School District. 3E, City Ordinance 16017, is an ordinance authorizing the conveyance of Block 25101, Lot 51. Excuse me, if you're leaving, please, we have a meeting. Lot 51, more commonly known by the street address of 152 Martin Luther King Drive, to the Redevelopment Agency, the Jersey City Redevelopment Agency. 3F, City Ordinance 16018, is a refunding bond ordinance of the City of Jersey City and the County of Hudson, State of New Jersey, the city providing for, one, the refunding of certain outstanding qualified general improvement bonds, series 2009, and qualified general improvement bonds, Parking Authority Project Series 2009A of the city dated February 10th, 2009 and December 30th, 2009, respectively, to provide debt service savings, and two, authorizing the issuance of not to exceed $32 million aggregate principal amount of general improvement refunding bonds of the city to effectuate such refunding and appropriating the proceeds therefore. 3G, City Ordinance 16019, an ordinance supplementing Chapter 332, Vehicles and Traffic, Article 3, Parking, Standing, and Stopping of the Jersey City Code, amending Section 332-24, Parking Prohibited Certain Hours, extending the no parking school days 100 feet south to the end of the gate at the Golden Door Charter School. 3H, City Ordinance 16020, is an ordinance approving a five-year tax exemption pursuant to the provisions of New Jersey statutes annotated 40A:21-1 at SEC and Section 304-9 of the Municipal Code for property designated as Block 6301, Lot 1, on the city's tax map and more commonly known by the street address of 271 Van Wagenen Avenue. Three I, City Ordinance 16021, an ordinance approving a 15-year tax exemption for a mixed-use market-rate condominium project to be constructed by 9th Street 2 Urban Renewal, LLC, an urban renewal entity pursuant to the long-term tax exemption law, New Jersey statutes annotated 40A:20-1 et sec. J, City Ordinance 16022, an ordinance approving a 20-year tax exemption for a mixed-use market-rate residential project to be constructed by Pacific 312 Group Urban Renewal, LLC, an urban renewal entity, pursuant to the long-term tax exemption law, New Jersey statutes annotated, 40A:20-1 et sec. 3K, City Ordinance 16023, for the project at Summit Avenue, the Vishnu Ma Summit Urban Renewal has been withdrawn. 3L is 16, Ordinance 16024, franchise ordinance of the City Council of the City of Jersey City, granting permission to PS First Hudson Urban Renewal, LLC, its successors and assigns, to make improvements in the First Street, Second Street, Provo Street, and Warren Street right-of-way adjacent to the property located at 133 2nd Street and designated as Block 11503, Lot 1, on the tax map of the City of Jersey City, New Jersey. So, council members, we're voting on 3A through 3L, noting that K was withdrawn. Councilperson Gajewski?
No. Listen.
Ramchal?
He stepped away.
I don't see.
Bajano?
I'm going to say yes, but I want to make one thing known. I think we're going to, I just spoke to the attorney on 3K before. I want to sit down with him and the developers, and I'm becoming totally, let's say, disenchanted with all these 30-year tax abatements. I think it has to stop. I found out some other issues on this here through the Jersey City Redevelopment Agency, but I think we have to sit down, we have to talk, and 30-year abatements have to be out, but I'm going to vote yes for them all right now.
Rich, just so you know, 3K was withdrawn.
K is withdrawn.
It was withdrawn.
A through L, K was withdrawn. Councilperson Yun.
No, it was withdrawn. When was it withdrawn?
He just said it.
I indicated that before I read the vote.
Right.
By the administration.
K has been withdrawn by the administration. Yun, Councilman Yun, 3A through 3L, K withdrawn.
Okay. I vote for I for introduction, except I and J.
I and J, you're voting no?
Yes, I especially.
Okay.
The tiered, they actually, you know, 10 years area, tax abatement, but they ask 5 years with a bonus. The bonus amount they pay, I'm not happy with that, and not enough. And the J also, so.
Okay.
No to I and J, rest of vote for I for introduction.
Thank you. Councilperson Coleman.
I'd just like to say about K also is that we've been throwing 30-year tax abatements around like cold water, and I think we did a lot of looking into this project. I think it's a great developer. He's done everything that the city and the redevelopment agency has asked him to do, and I just hope that we can sit down to the table and come up with something that will be good for the community and for the developer. And I vote aye for introduction on everything else.
Councilperson Rivera?
I really didn't appreciate that K was withdrawn.
I don't either, Danny.
Right now. Like Councilwoman Coleman said, you know, these guys have really made sure that everything is done right. Whether it's a 20-year, 30-year, but you can't just, you know, take something off the agenda.
because you feel like it.
I agree, Danny.
I think that we should definitely talk about it in discussion. I hope that this comes back at the next meeting and this doesn't stay pulled for such a long time. I vote aye.
Councilperson Waterman?
I vote aye for introduction.
Council President?
Councilperson Osborne just arrived. Do you want me to vote now?
You can vote, and I'll catch up with the others.
Okay.
Person Osborne,
so,
came in. We'll record her present at 6:45.
Great. So on 3I, we're going to vote aye for introduction on that one. But just want to make it clear that still waiting for kind of the audited financial construction costs. And also, I don't think I made it clear that I really need to look at more closely at the kind of the fiscal impact studies and so forth around that. But I'm definitely going to vote aye for introduction on that. With regard to K, I just want to say, so the ordinance was withdrawn, and the reason being is that it wasn't just a feeling. It was after some discussion and deliberation.
With who?
with other council members as well as the administration and with our experts as well, and talking about the idea that, you know, 30-year abatements and, you know, what's our stomach for that here in the city kind of going forward. As I acknowledged and when I called and told the developers that we were looking to withdraw this, informed them that we appreciate the idea that you prescribe to what was provided in the policy. There's an executive policy out there, for those who are not familiar with it, an abatement policy that calls for certain areas that can be eligible for tax abatements or pilots for a certain number of years, and Journal Square being one of those areas being 30 years. In hindsight, kind of looking at that and reviewing some of the things that are coming forward, looking at that and saying maybe that's too much for this particular project. Are we seeing the kind of benefits and impact for Jersey City that we want to see when we give away that rich and that generous an abatement? Are we seeing the kind of affordable housing that we've seen when we've done a 20-year in downtown for the first time in 30 years, and we got 20% affordable housing there? Are we Diane, can I show me respect and allow me to speak my mind?
I'm very sorry, Council President. I was just voicing my opinion.
Well, you had your time, and then if you want to say it afterwards, you can do that as well.
Okay.
Thank you. So, it's the idea that it's maybe it's a little too. Are we getting the kind of impact for Jersey City and Jersey City residents? I will acknowledge the developers are good guys. They're local guys, minority developers, a rare thing in Jersey City among developers. And so that definitely plays into the idea that we want to be able to support local developers and minority developers and that sort of thing. At the same time, we can't do it for giving it away, right? So I'm not saying that that's the case here. We want to take a closer look. And between now and the next meeting, as I suggested, the developers, when we notify them, I'd sit down with them and go over some of the numbers and take a look at what might be a more manageable number that the city can do so that they can get the project off the ground, because we want to see the development in that area as well. So with that being said, I vote aye for introduction and all.
Okay, let me come back to Councilperson Ramchal. Your vote, Councilperson Ramchal? On A through L, K being withdrawn.
Aye for introduction.
Thank you. Councilperson Osborne?
Aye for introduction.
Okay, we have K withdrawn. The other only exceptions to the 9-0 introduction is 3I and 3J. Both voted introduced 8-1. Councilman Yun voting no. To second reading ordinances. Is Second reading ordinances. We have item 4A. City Ordinance 16001, an ordinance supplementing chapter 332, Vehicles and Traffic, Article 3, Parking, Standing and Stopping, amending Section 332-22, Parking Prohibited at All Times of the Jersey City Code, repealing the no parking anytime on the south side of Bay Street, beginning 130 feet west of Provo Street to Marin Boulevard. This is a public hearing on the ordinance. Are there any members of the public wishing to be heard?
Motion.
Second.
We have a motion by Councilperson Waterman. Was that you, Councilman Ramshaw?
I'm sorry. Go ahead, continue.
Yeah.
Thank you. To close the public hearing, Councilperson Gajewski. Ramchal.
Aye.
Bajiano.
Aye.
Yun.
Aye.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera.
Aye.
Waterman.
Aye.
Lavaro.
Aye.
We have a 9-0 vote to close the public hearing for final adoption of 4A, City Ordinance 16001. Councilperson Gajewski. Ramchal.
Aye.
Bajiano.
Aye.
Yun.
Aye.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera.
Aye.
Waterman.
Aye.
Council President.
Aye. And Robert, after we're finished here, I want to make a motion to defer to 10Z1 after this.
Okay, let me recap. We have a 9-0 vote for the approval of Item 4A, City Ordinance 16001. We have a second to the Council President's deferral to 10Z1.
Second.
By Councilperson Osborne. To defer, Councilperson Gajewski.
Aye.
Ramchal.
Aye.
Bajiano.
Aye.
Yun.
Aye.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera.
He would have stayed.
Waterman.
Aye.
Lavaro.
Aye.
We have an 8-0 vote to defer. 10Z1. 10Z1 is the resolution regarding Liberty State Park. It's a resolution of the Municipal Council of the City of Jersey City condemning Governor Chris Christie and the New Jersey Department of Environmental Protection for the undated report, The Future of Liberty State Park, released on or about November 24, 2015, which proposes to commercialize and privatize Liberty State Park.
Rather than read it into the record, may I invite Sam Pessin up to share a few words? And
thank you, council people.
Are we going to take a vote, council members, before Sam speak? Or
okay, we can take the votes.
Okay.
Sam, just give us a minute.
On the resolution, council person Gajewski.
Sam, I just want to tell you, thank you for your hard work and dedication. I use Liberty State Park as well. Support you 100%. I vote aye.
Councilperson Bajiano?
Sam, I vote aye. But do me a favor, what we spoke about, let's get a train museum down there, all right?
Councilperson Yun?
Thank you for your hard work, Sam, and I vote for aye. Keep the good work.
Mm-hmm. Councilperson Osborne.
Liberty State Park is the only active passive space for tens of thousands of Jersey City residents that is within a reasonable distance from their home. Mm-hmm. And the constant attempt of the state of New Jersey to try and commercialize it is absolutely wrong. It is not fair. You know, starting back with President Teddy Roosevelt, this country decided that it was important to take beautiful, unique pieces of land and preserve it for the residents of this country. New Jersey State did that under the pushing of the Pessin family to preserve Liberty State Park. It needs to continue as Liberty State Park, and I strongly encourage the state government to reverse any thoughts they have for what they're going to do with Liberty State Park. I vote aye.
Councilperson Coleman.
Thanks for everything, Sam. I vote aye.
Thank you.
Councilman Rivera is out of the room. Councilperson Waterman.
You have my support, Sam. I vote aye.
Thank you.
Council President.
I'll just echo what Councilperson Osborne said. So Liberty State Park, crown jewel of our park system, visited by hundreds of thousands of people, millions annually. We've had our Tough Mudder there, 4th of July, major events. It's a huge attraction, not just for Jersey City residents and an oasis for Jersey City residents, but it's an attraction to New Jersey and beyond. It's a national attraction in many regards. And so people coming long and far to visit, to see Liberty State Park, and we should do everything we can to protect it for its passive use and for the enjoyment of the urban community of Jersey City, which has so little open space and green space. So I applaud you, Sam Pessin, the Friends of the Lows, and your coalition for the work that you're doing. I want you to know we stand with you, and let the governor know and that we're going to fight this every step of the way, and there'll be no privatization at Liberty State Park. I vote aye.
Okay, we have an 8-0 vote for the approval of the resolution. Want to say thank you, Sam, very quickly?
Yes. Actually, the city clerk has given me 3 minutes, which I promise I won't go over. I do want to say thank you to you all for standing up in this vote for Liberty State Park. Mayor Fulop has been with us in the last year on the front lines of this battle. As the council president mentioned, there is now a coalition to save Liberty State Park with 40 organizations from the city and the state. And we have a website, savelsp.org, with a petition. And the coalition to save Liberty State Park, that title has been used many times before because, as Councilwoman Osborne mentioned, there have been many attempts to commercialize the park. And the good news about the park is that the people have always stood up, put democracy into practice, and fought for a free park behind the Statue of Liberty, and the people are ready to fight again. The governor's wrong to want Liberty Park to pay for itself. The park serves the public good. As Councilwoman Waterman mentioned to the student leader, this is about fighting for what's right, fighting the good fight. And the park is sacred land, it's priceless land, it's our green sanctuary in this crowded region. So I will email you all. The Friends have a 10-page opposition statement to their 18-page report going into some details. I will mention, other than these plans being an attack on the purpose and meaning of the park, it really is an attack on the public's use, the urban people's use of the park, because a couple of their plans, especially a commercial amphitheater and letting a big promoter like AG or Live Nation book way too many large events on the waterfront lawns, would cause traffic jams. The park is already jam-packed on warm weekends, on hot weekends, and if you have big events every weekend, then that'll keep the general public out. And this park, as you are standing up for the park today, must be certainly protected for future generations. So God bless you all. This is the people's park, and we'll certainly work together to protect it. And thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Sam.
Sir, you were out of the room. Would you like to join the vote on 10Z1?
I vote aye.
You have a 9-0 vote for the approval of 10Z1, the Liberty State Park Resolution. We're at second reading ordinances. We are to item 4B. 4B is City Ordinance 16002, an ordinance supplementing 332 vehicles and traffic, Article 3, parking, standing, and stopping, amending Section 332-22, parking prohibited at all times of the Jersey City Code, extending the no parking anytime on the south side of Clifton Place, beginning at Summit Avenue from 200 feet east to 281 feet east. This is a public hearing on the ordinance. Any members of the public wishing to be heard?
Motion.
Second.
We have a motion by Councilperson Waterman, seconded by the Council President. To close the public hearing, Councilperson Gajewski.
Aye.
Councilperson Ramchal. Councilperson Bagiano.
Aye.
Yun.
Aye.
Coleman. Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera. Waterman.
Aye.
Council President.
Aye.
We have a 9-0 vote to close the public hearing. Councilperson Gajewski.
Aye.
Ramchal.
Aye.
Bagiano.
Aye.
Yun.
Aye.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera. Waterman.
Aye.
Council President.
Aye.
We have a 9-0 vote for the final adoption of item 4B, City Ordinance 16002. On to item 4C, City Ordinance 16003, an ordinance supplementing the Traffic Code, Chapter 332, Vehicles and Traffic, Article 2, Traffic Regulations, Section 332-7, prohibited turns at intersections of the Jersey City Code, prohibiting the left turn for vehicles exiting east from Dunkin' Donuts to north on Martin Luther King Drive daily. This is a public hearing on the ordinance. Are there any members of the public wishing to be heard?
Motion.
Second.
We have a motion by Councilperson Waterman to close and a second by Councilperson Osborne to close. Councilperson Gajewski. Ramchal.
Aye.
Bagiano.
Aye.
Yun.
Aye.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera.
Aye.
Waterman.
Aye.
Lavaro.
Aye.
We have a 9-0 vote for the final adoption of item 4C, City Ordinance 16003. Councilperson Gajewski. Aye. Ramchal.
Aye.
Bagiano.
Aye.
Yun.
Aye.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera. Waterman.
Aye.
Council President.
Aye.
We have a 9-0 vote for the final adoption of item 4C, City Ordinance 16003. On to item 4D, City Ordinance 16004, an ordinance supplementing Chapter 332, Vehicles and Traffic, Article 3, Parking, Standing, and Stopping, amending Section 332-22.
Rainy.
No parking anytime, designating the north side of Montgomery Street between Jordan Avenue and Torres Avenue as no stopping or standing. This is a public hearing on the subject ordinance. Are there any members of the public wishing to be heard?
Yeah, I'd like to just say something about this.
Let's close the public hearing. You can speak when we vote. Who's making a motion to close? Councilperson Waterman?
Second.
Thank you. Councilperson Ramchal. To close the public hearing. Councilperson Gajewski. Ramchal.
Aye.
Bagiano to close.
Aye.
Yun?
Aye.
Osborne?
Aye.
Coleman?
Aye.
Rivera?
Aye.
Waterman?
Aye.
Lavaro?
Aye.
We have a 9-0 vote to close the public hearing. For final adoption, Councilperson Gajewski.
No, but you want to say something?
Oh, wait. I'd like to say something before you take the vote, Bob. St. Peter's is going to be closing their parking lot to build a building right next to here. And across the street, the parking lot, which the parking authority used to own, is going to be another high-rise building. There's no parking around this area whatsoever. And now they're taking away a whole load of parking spaces. It's not right. I mean, this is absolutely ridiculous what they're doing. The area is so congested now. St. Peter's is going to be dumping, what, about 200 cars in the street every day? And so is the parking garage across the parking lot across the street, probably another 50 to 100 cars. And here you're taking away more parking spaces on the street. I think it's wrong.
Who's this region?
It's mine. It's in Ward C.
They're not discussed with you there?
Nope. Typical.
Come
of
on.
What goes on.
Come on. Right. The councilman or C don't even know where they're.
I didn't know about it till the other night when we got the package.
Generally, this is second reading.
It's a second reading, yes.
Second reading,
I know.
Generally,
yes.
I didn't
know about the problem. I should explain it. I didn't know about the problems people were saying, where they're going to park, area residents and everything. Not everybody has a driveway.
So what do you propose?
What happened? What's the problem now here?
What do you propose, Councilman?
I'm saying no. I think... Leave the parking spaces alone. You're taking away a whole
Council, let me explain.
Yeah.
This was a safety issue. Yeah. What happened was when the median work was done there at McGinley Square, it narrowed the roadway. So now you had two lanes of traffic going west towards the west side of the city. When the median was recreated there, it made the gap narrower. The two rows of traffic now were encroaching upon the parking spaces there. Those cars were in jeopardy of being hit.
Yes.
The traffic engineering and the municipal engineer made a decision that this is a safety issue. We had to remove the meters in order to protect those cars from getting hit. So we can never have authorized parking there because, cars traveling west would be in danger of hitting those parked cars.
Let me ask you this. Who was the genius that did that work in the middle of the street there? Because I go to the meetings there, the police meetings, and everybody's talking about it. They couldn't believe what was done. The people that live on the street, was it Orchard Street and the other streets, couldn't believe what was done there. That should be taken away.
Okay, that's a different issue, Councilman. That was done last year.
I know.
Okay.
It's a problem for the people over there for the last year.
So we have to decide the public safety or
Councilperson safety. Councilperson, you're voting, sir? Then we'll come back to you for your vote, Councilman Bajano. Right.
Which was away? You was away.
You weren't here at the last call?
No, I think it was.
Councilman Ramchal?
I was away.
Can I have your vote?
Yeah.
Your vote on 3-4-D, sir? Councilperson Ramchal?
I'll abstain on this.
Councilperson Bajano?
No.
Your vote?
No.
Councilperson Yun?
Well, actually, Councilman Richie Bojana fully get informed that issue because the first, when you have a first, like, the first reading for the, caucus meeting, yes. Caucus meeting, he was not there. He didn't wear that. And now we understand that the parking is a major issue in that corner, but also we have to understand the public safety. So I like to respect the Councilman Richie Bojano's argument, but there's public safety issues. So I vote for aye.
Councilperson Osborne?
Thank you for explaining the public safety issue. I mean, I have a strong preference to defer to the councilman of the ward. However, my conscience compels me, if it is a safety issue, to vote aye.
Councilperson Coleman?
What safety issue?
I have to go with my colleague. I usually respect the councilperson of the area because they know the area better than we do. We concentrate in our area like he concentrates in his. However, I've experienced it myself on Clifton Place. Around the turn, you can't get around the turn because cars are parked on both sides of the street, and you're either going to scratch somebody or hit somebody. And the same thing on this corner. If those cars aren't moved, somebody's car is going to be damaged. So I have to go to what makes sense to me, the public safety issue, and I vote aye.
Councilperson Rivera?
I vote aye.
Thank you. Councilperson Waterman?
I vote aye.
Council President?
Aye.
We have a 7-1-1 vote for the final adoption, a no by councilperson Bajiano, abstention by councilman Ramchal. On to item 4E. City Ordinance 16005, an ordinance supplementing Chapter 332, Vehicles and Traffic, Article 2, Traffic Regulations, Section 332-7.
We'll see.
Prohibited turns at intersections of the Jersey City Traffic Code, prohibiting the left turn for vehicles traveling north on Romaine Avenue to west on Broadway, school days, 7:30 a.m. to 9 a.m. and 2 p.m. to 4 p.m. This is a public hearing on the ordinance. Are there any members of the public wishing to be heard?
Motion.
Second.
We have a motion by Councilperson Waterman, seconded by Councilperson Osborne, to close the public hearing. Councilperson Gajewski.
Aye.
Ramchal.
Aye.
Bajiano.
Aye.
Yun.
Aye.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera.
Aye.
Waterman. Lavara.
Aye.
Aye.
We have a 9-0 vote for the close of the public hearing for final adoption. Councilperson Gajewski. Ramchal.
Aye.
Bajiano.
Aye.
Yun.
Aye.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera.
Aye.
Rivera.
Aye.
Thank you, sir. Waterman.
Aye.
Lavara.
Aye.
We have a 9-0 vote for the final adoption of item 4E. City Ordinance 16005. On to 16006, item 4F. It's an ordinance supplementing Chapter 332, Vehicles and Traffic, Article 3, Parking, Standing and Stopping, and Article 9, Parking for the Disabled of the Jersey City Code, designating a reserved parking spaces at 117 Atlantic Street, 389 Baldwin Avenue, 398 Baldwin Avenue, 38 Bartholdi Avenue, 142 Beacon Avenue, 80 Belmont Avenue, 175 Bidwell Avenue, 274 Claremont Avenue, 43 Clark Avenue, 46 Clark Avenue, 80 Cole Street, 165 Congress Street, 34 Eastern Parkway, 353 8th Street, 79 Erie Street, 305 Fairmont Avenue, 19 Fairmont Terrace, 375 4th Street, 195 Hutton Street, 22 Irving Street, 119 Irving Street, 34 Lexington Avenue, 239 241 Lexington Avenue, 8 Manhattan Avenue, 399 New York Avenue, 254 9th Street, 120 Ogden Avenue, 237 Pacific Avenue, 12 Pamripo Avenue, 238 Pearsall Avenue, 242 Pine Street, 149 Randolph Avenue, 23 Reed Street, 65 Reservoir Avenue, 219 St. Paul's Avenue, 84 Seaview Avenue, 279 and a half Second Street, 87 Sherman Avenue, 285 Sherman Avenue, 1416 Skyline Drive, 159 South Street, 45 Stegman Street, 141 Stevens Avenue, 1191 Summit Avenue, 23 Terhune Avenue, 213 Terrace Avenue, 99 Thorn Street, 78 Union Street, 28 Wallace Avenue, and 291 Woodlawn Avenue, and repealing the reserved parking space at 110, 112, 114 Atlantic Street, 192 Clinton Avenue, 359 8th Street, 63 Reservoir Avenue, and 66 Seidler Street. This is a public hearing on the ordinance. Are there any members of the public wishing to be heard?
Motion.
Second.
We have a motion by the council president, seconded by councilperson Waterman. Close the public hearing. Councilperson Gajewski.
Aye.
Ramchal.
Aye.
Bajiano.
Aye.
Yun.
Aye.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera. Waterman.
Them, yeah.
Councilperson Waterman.
Aye.
Council President?
Aye.
We have a 9-0 vote to close the public hearing. For final adoption, Councilperson Gajewski.
Aye.
Ramchal.
Yeah. Before I vote, I just want to get on the record. Yeah. I mean, this is a lot of handicap signs that's going up all over in the city. But I think traffic and engineer, I know Councilperson Waterman is on the board, and she's trying her best to make this possible, because we need to eliminate those handicap signs that we have on the street that people not using. They need to do a survey, get those handicap signs off before we install new handicap sign. I mean, I'm not going to deny that we don't need, these people don't deserve the signs, but I will ask the council president, we need to have Pat Logan or someone from traffic and engineer come to the next caucus meeting, because I want to know what their plans are to remove these handicap signs, because myself, and I don't know for my other colleague, I got complained, a lot of handicap sign on the street, and people don't live there no more, you know, and they're not removing these signs. So I want to know what's going on with that. So I would like to have someone from traffic and engineer at the next caucus meeting. And if we could get a study with how much handicap sign, how many handicap sign that we have in the city right now.
Your vote, sir?
I vote aye. I'm not going to deny it.
Councilperson Baggiano?
Aye.
Yun?
Aye.
Osborne?
Aye.
Coleman?
Aye.
Rivera?
Aye.
Waterman?
Okay. Before I vote, let me just explain something, because my colleague here, he requesting something, and I'm on the board. Frank is on the board. And Rich is on the board. Now, part of the challenge we have is doing a survey. And what the survey will do, the survey will allow for those who really don't need the handicap signs. But we have to factor in a person to take the slot to do the survey. You need a person to work. That's as simple as I can get it. You need a person that can work to do the survey. And a survey takes time to do. Is not just like you're just going to fill out paper. No, they have to go and survey the land. They have to look up certain numbers. It takes time to do a survey. And I want to defend traffic and engineering, because I am on the board and I see the packs of people that apply for handicap parking. They do a terrific job over there. We just need somehow to factor in another person that can do a survey, so we can pretty much control those who get handicap stickers, okay? That's what I want to say. So they do a terrific job. Pat and them really don't need to come over here. We just need another person to do
all right, survey. So can I? So
let's finish the vote.
Councilperson Waterman, your vote? Your
yes,
vote?
Aye.
Council President?
Can I say something?
Go ahead. Go ahead.
So, all right, Councilperson Waterman. So if that's be the case and they're doing a good job, mm-hmm. then we need more manpower. So you guys being on the board, mm-hmm. let's sit with the BA and figure how we could get more manpower over there. So this
just
way
tell the BA.
Regard the situation.
Okay.
Thank you, Rich.
Joyce says that breaks up backside.
Thank you.
Okay.
Okay, Council President.
All right, so I'll just chime in. We're in budget season. So you've heard the council people, there's desire to see more manpower in that department, in that division. I would say that if this is a one-off kind of project, we might want to look at hiring a consultant or someone to conduct the survey and complete that, and it does a one-time expense in that sense. With that being said, I vote aye.
We have a 9-0 vote for the final adoption of item 4F, City Ordinance 16006. On to item 4G, City Ordinance 16007, an ordinance amending and supplementing Chapter 332.
I'm going to make a motion.
Traffic metered parking of the Jersey City Municipal Code.
Oh, this is not, is this mine? No.
No.
Okay.
Walser?
Yes. Could you please explain, this is meter parking, what are you doing? What are you changing?
He simply clarifies that the meter hours are from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m., or as designated on the meter itself,
so
that there's no ambiguity.
We have meters all over the city, and you know, I know a specific person who has a meter, you know, he's over the commercial street in front of his house. So if you're going to have a meter, normally the meter's expired, wasn't it 5 o'clock before? 7?
It depends on where in the city the meter is.
See, you know, this is the problem we're having. You're taking away parking, and if you're expanding the meter hours, you're just looking at taxpayers as a piggy bank. It's the taxes. There is no parking lots.
So there is. I understand the parking frustration, because that's a very real concern that people throughout the city have been expressing. But just so you understand, on this particular ordinance, it's just house cleaning. There's not really a rule change happening. It's just the previous version of the ordinance didn't set a time.
What is it?
Just 1 second.
Let him finish there.
So what has been put in here is generally the practice that was in place, and we just memorialized it, and it says from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m., Monday through Sunday, unless designated otherwise by sign on the meter or a posted sign. So the rules of meters throughout the city are going to stay the same, and so when you go to an area, if it's a 5 o'clock metered area or a 7 o'clock metered area, that's going to be what's posted on the meter or on a parking sign, and that's going to be the rules. So I want to be clear, we're not expanding meter time or doing anything like that. It's just house cleaning.
For anyone to have a meter for 9 p.m. is outrageous. It's absolutely outrageous. The meters should be at 5 p.m. People park on the street when they come in, and I know people who go around the block or sit in front of their house until something pops up. My husband was one of them, because we lost our parking, because our garage that we rented from became one of a condo. So the place we parked for 20 plus years became a condo. So we went back on the street. And when we went back on the street, he would wait inside, you know, hours on end, if we had it around the evening, to make sure we had parking. I mean, what you're doing is handicapping people who pay taxes to Jersey City, and I think it is outrageous that we would have a meter past 5 o'clock in the city when people are coming home from work. I think it's outrageous. You're putting your hands in people's pockets so they can pay fines. And it's difficult. I know what it is. When my mother was alive, and we would bring her to the doctor, and you have to be someplace. Not every doctor was in a medical complex. They used regular streets. And I remember waiting, you know, my husband would be in the car, I would take him inside, 3 hours in there. You're always looking at how can you put your hands in our pockets. And I think this is outrageous. I think this roll back to 5 o'clock. There is no reason why any meter should be past 5 o'clock at all.
Thank you, Mrs. Balser. The public hearing.
Motion.
By okay. Council President Lavaro, seconded. Was that you, Councilperson Osborne?
Yes.
Close the public hearing. Councilperson Bajewski. Ramchal.
Aye.
Bajano.
Aye.
Yun.
Aye.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera.
Aye.
Waterman. Council President.
Aye.
We have a 9-0 to close. For final adoption, Council
Robert,
person.
Before we do final vote,
I got a question.
There's some discussion. Councilman Ramchal.
BA and Cooperation Council. All right, so with this ordinance, how are we going to know which meter it's 5 o'clock, which is 9 o'clock?
We already have, I'm sorry.
It's already on the meters. This is not changing any of the meters' current times. If it's designated 9 o'clock on the meter, then it's 9 o'clock. If it's designated 5 p.m. on it, it stays the same. There's no changes to any of the meters in the city.
And so if there's nothing, then the default is 9 p.m.?
It defaults to 9.
So I would argue that probably most of them don't have something. I brought this up when we had this conversation.
That'd be proper signage then.
They don't have appropriate signage. The sticker's been ripped off.
Right.
I would like to ask, and I said, as long as they guarantee and they're going to make sure that there's stickers or signage on all these meters in appropriate places if there's exceptions to the 9-to-9 rule. And so could we change the effect date on this? Folks, can I get your...
Hello.
Are you hearing? Hear me? Can we alter the effective date that this goes into effect so that somebody
yes.
can take the time to make sure that the signage is appropriate? Because I know for a fact that the stickers are like torn off all over the place.
And I'd like to add to that, we go to Montgomery Street because we have other meetings. And you have Montgomery Street on here between the areas that we have to park. And we do just what Yvonne said. We sit out there in the parking lot at the space until 6 o'clock, and then we go to a meeting because you can't run from the 14th floor back down to a meter to put the money in. So some of these areas, I think that it's like the council president said, it needs to be a clarification because you're saying 9-to-9 for some of these areas like Fairmont Avenue and Monticello Avenue, and those are actual residential parking places. How's the person going to come in from work and go home and have to run downstairs every hour to put money in the meter? I think it should be relooked.
Why don't we just change it from all meters till 5 o'clock? Make it simple.
Well 5 o'clock is probably not the appropriate time.
6 o'clock it is was because, Montgomery Street.
Like Yvonne said, people come home, they want to go up to their house, or go in their house, they have to run outside to feed a meter at 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock. It's ridiculous. So put in a dollar.
Yeah, but so you're talking about a street that's very residential, but there are meters in commercial. Most residential streets don't have
commercial
meters.
Districts. Yeah.
We're talking about commercial districts. You're talking about mixed-use districts. So that's why it's a balance.
All right, that's an harassment to the businessmen on Central Avenue, let's say, that have to the people have to go shopping and they have to.
But you got to turn over those meters so that other people can. So if you go to downtown and you go to a metered spot there, it's if that spot is taken up by somebody at 5 p.m. and it's out of commission, out of use for anybody else for the rest of the night.
Yeah. So what's appropriate for one area may not be appropriate for another. So for instance, on Central Avenue, it is. Primarily a commercial district, you're going to want to turn over those meters. You're not going to want people parking there for a long period of times. And certainly after 5, a lot of those restaurants still serving dinner. But whereas in a mixed-use area like on Bergen Avenue, most of those businesses are closing around 5 or 6, so it might make sense, which is why it's labeled on the meters specific to the area.
I never saw it.
Jeremy?
Passes all the ordinances... establishing the times of all the metered parking. It's all in our code.
Jeremy?
It's already been voted upon by the council what zone is until what time. So
yes, Councilman.
If you want to revisit that, that's...
Yeah. Jeremy, actually, I have no objection. And my concern is that everybody even say that problem is that the sign on the meters... You know, a lot of meter doesn't have to sign. Actually, it gets confused, you know.
Well, I understand. We got to go through the
as
city.
As long as you do that, you know, we can customize that the enforcement hours that depend the area. Actually, it's provide more service to the people of Georgia City. So I'm in favor, but only concern is that improper sign. That is the issue.
And to Council President's point, if you want to change the effective date of the ordinance, you can do that. That's not a material
beautiful.
Change.
Beautiful. That is even better. Okay.
So you would just make an amendment to it.
Yeah. Okay. So how we kept it?
So I make a motion to amend, section 32-52 D. Is that right? Am I looking at the right?
D.
Or am I looking at the wrong one?
Yeah, no. We've got 32-52D.
Amend effective date to what date?
What is it? Today's January 3rd, so... January 1st, 2015.
Yeah. Of March 1st.
Amend effective
90 days?
Date.
Yeah, 90 days.
90
more.
Days? Yeah. So what is that? February, March, April, May 1st.
Of 2016.
2016.
Yeah.
Amend effective date to May 2016.
That work?
Yes.
Okay. That on the amendment, who makes a second to the motion to the amendment?
Me.
Who's me? Councilperson Ramchal.
On the motion to amend the effective date to May 2016, Councilperson Gajewski. Ramchal?
One more thing, Jeremy. Can we have, instead, I know you're going to put sign, but people just go, they have, you know, sometimes there's old saying, you can't teach old dog new tricks. So they know the meter, they just put the money in the meter. But if we could have signage, regular signage, street sign as well.
And meter signs.
A meter sign is fine, but street sign as well, stating that meter parking, you know, 7 to 9, whatever.
Yeah, that way we won't even pull into the space.
Yeah, because the sign is right here looking at you, so you can't say I didn't know. And if the meter is not working, you know.
I can tell you that by business experience, signing the meter is more impact than street sign. It's like halfway along, nobody can see. So
I agree, but I think
signing the meter is more than enough.
Okay. Yeah. Councilman Ramchal, you know on the motion.
Look, I don't care if Councilman Young don't want it in Ward D. I need it in Ward B. So that's done.
Councilman
Ramchal,
okay. On the motion to amend.
I vote aye.
Fagiano.
So if you guys are going to debate me with this,
Fagiano.
I want it.
Fagiano?
Aye.
Yun?
I vote aye, and Councilman Chico, you can have it.
Yeah.
Councilperson Osborne?
I mean, like, you have senior citizens that go park in his meters.
Okay, we're going to
all right.
Maintain Chico. Order here. Maintain
Coleman.
Order.
Aye.
Rivera?
I thank God for medication.
Damn,
I vote aye.
Councilperson Waterman?
Aye.
Council President?
Aye.
The amendment is approved 9-0 to adopt as amended. Councilperson Gajewski. Ramchal.
Aye.
Fagiano.
Aye.
Yun.
I will aye with amend.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera.
Aye.
Waterman.
Aye.
Lavara.
Yeah, and to the BA. So just the signage, that's DPW or parking? Who's going to take care of that?
DPW.
And ultimately, it's really you. As far as we're concerned.
Well, the actual signs that Councilman Ramchal is asking about would be DPW.
Yeah.
Any signage actually on the parking meter itself is from the enforcement division.
Okay. Well, what if wants signs too? Both.
Okay.
There you go, girl.
And you're all over it, right?
Yeah. All right.
Got it. Thank you.
I got a lengthy list tonight from the council.
Thank you.
Bro. I vote aye.
Okay, we have an adopted vote, 9-0 for as amended for city ordinance. 16-007. Item 4H, 16-008, an ordinance of the Municipal Council of the City of Jersey City adopting amendments to the Land Development Ordinance, R3 Multifamily Mid-Rise District. This is a public hearing on the ordinance. Any members of the public wishing to be heard?
Yvonne Balser. Could you please explain first what is an R3 multifamily mid-rise? How many units would that be?
Mr. Wanger, you want to join us for this conversation?
Hey, Jeff. Sorry, let me...
Can you do it from the podium? We're having a little bit of... Okay.
Question, can you explain what an R3 multifamily mid-rise district is?
Okay, what was the question? Sorry.
Could you explain what is an R3 multifamily mid-rise, how many units is that?
How many units is it?
Yeah.
The units.
It's not a... Mid-rise buildings are defined in the ordinance as being above five stories, I believe. That's all that's a reference
that's
to.
That's all it says, five stories? Nothing, and there's no...
term mid-rise means.
So it could be five, or it could be 50, or it could be 100 in.
There is a building height maximum in the zone. Hold on one moment. Let me look at it.
Yvonne, can I just make a just clarification to you about what we're voting on. Mm-hmm. They had redundant wording in an existing ordinance that was in two different places, and we're striking it from one place so it's not confusing.
So what was the redundant language that you
The wording that we're striking is provided all bulk and parking standards are met. That does not mean we're not doing it. It's just that another section in the ordinance says that all the parking standards have to be met, and it was in two different places, and we put ourselves at legal liability because we had the same phrase in two spots in the same ordinance.
So basically you're reducing parking then, huh?
No, that is not true. The parking is not changing at all. It says it in another place in the same ordinance, and when we say it in two places,
it makes us
legally liable.
So what is the parking for this if it's...
That can be found in paragraph G below. And it gives you parking standard for mid-rise buildings.
She doesn't have the actual copy of the ordinance.
Further down on paragraph G, parking standard for mid-rise apartment buildings.
And so there's none for efficiency, a half a space for one bedroom, you know, one for two or more bedrooms.
Yeah, okay. And this is all existing law. We're not changing that at all.
That's been on the books for I don't know how long.
I tend to think that we should have one-to-one. It works. It works in my building. People in my condo, they park on the inside because they don't want to shovel snow, and they use it. We like to pretend people don't park, but I have a two-bedroom. Next to me is a guy with a studio, and he parks inside the building because it's there. So for people to say people in studios do not use their parking lots, that's ridiculous. Nobody in my building parks on the street because they don't want to deal with vandalism, they don't want to deal with snow, and they don't want to deal with theft. So to say that otherwise is the city pretending. I mean, do any of you give up your cars? How many of you bike here to City Hall? What people should do in the reality, there is laws that saying that people in studios do not have cars, which is ridiculous. They'll be out on the street taking the parking from somebody else. The city is not living in the real world. They're living in a pretend world where people don't have cars. And the reality is, if you look in Jersey City, they have cars. Why don't you do something for us once in a while and stop pretending people stop having cars? It causes people fighting, physically fighting, I've seen this, over parking spaces. Or putting a garbage can there to hold a parking space because they're picking someone up. I mean, it's ridiculous. That's what you have reduced Jersey to do. People fighting over parking spaces because you're saying someone in a studio does not have a car. Ridiculous.
We have bikes. This is a public hearing. Does anyone wish to be heard?
Motion.
Second.
I'm giving it to you, Councilperson Waterman, and the second to Councilperson Osborne to close the public hearing. Councilperson Gajewski. Ramchal.
Aye.
Bargiano. Yun.
Aye.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera.
He stepped away.
He's a busy tonight.
Yeah.
Councilperson Waterman.
Aye.
Council President.
Aye.
8-0. Public hearing is closed. For final adoption, Councilperson Gajewski.
Aye.
Ramchal.
Aye.
Bargiano.
Aye.
Yun.
Aye.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Waterman.
Aye.
Michael.
Council President Lavaro.
Aye.
We have an 8-0 with Councilman Rivera out of the room. Back in the room, 9-0. For the final adoption of 4H, City Ordinance 16-008. On to 4I, City Ordinance 16009, an ordinance by the Municipal Council of the City of Jersey City amending Ordinance 15111, accepting the dedication of certain roadways, sidewalks, utilities, and the park located within the Liberty Harbor North redevelopment area. This is a public hearing on the ordinance. Are there any members of the public wishing to be heard?
Motion.
Second.
I heard the second by Councilperson Osborne. Who made the motion? Councilperson Rivera to close. Seconded by Councilperson Osborne to close. Councilperson Gajewski. Ramchal.
Aye.
Baggiano.
Aye.
Yun.
Aye.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera.
Aye.
Waterman.
Aye.
Lavaro.
Aye.
We have a 9-0 vote to close the public hearing. Final adoption. Councilperson Gajewski. Ramchal.
Aye.
Baggiano.
Aye.
Yun.
Aye.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera.
Aye.
Waterman.
Aye.
Lavaro.
Aye.
We have a 9-0 vote for the final adoption of item 4I, City Ordinance 16009. On to item 4J. 4J is City Ordinance 16010, an ordinance authorizing the transfer of city-owned property within the Morris Canal redevelopment area to the Jersey City Redevelopment Agency. The properties in question are 48 through 50 and 56 through 58 Maple Street. This is a public hearing on the ordinance. Are there any members of the public wishing to be heard?
Motion.
Jason Berg.
Jason's coming up.
All right, Jason Berg. Morris Canal redevelopment area to Jersey City redevelopment. These are, one is a public agency and one is a private agency?
Which one are we doing?
No, the property is located in the Morris Canal redevelopment area.
All right.
It's being transferred by the city, the owner, to the Jersey City Redevelopment Agency. Subjects to the provisions of the Morris Canal redevelopment area plans that are in place.
So this transfer, is this a title transfer with capital, or is this a title transfer?
It is technically a title transfer.
No money's being exchanged, just the ownership.
Well, they're going to act as our agent as they try to option the property to a developer to develop the property in line with the Morris Canal redevelopment plan. And at that point in time, whatever income realized will be transferred back to the city.
All right. Thank you very much.
Second.
We have a motion by Councilperson Rivera, seconded by Councilperson Waterman to close. Councilperson Gajewski. Ramchal.
Aye.
Baggiano.
Aye.
Close.
Close. Yun.
Aye.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Thank you, Corporate Counsel.
Closing.
Aye.
Rivera.
Aye.
Waterman.
Okay.
Councilperson Waterman?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you, Council President. We have a 9-0 vote to close the public hearing. For final adoption, Councilperson Gajewski? Ramchal?
Aye.
Baggiano?
Aye.
Yun?
No.
Osborne?
Aye.
No, let me
Coleman?
Say.
Hold on.
Yeah, hold on.
He isn't. He wasn't actually done.
Yes.
I heard him say no, and I kept moving.
Yeah. This two lot owned by City of Jersey City, without knowing that there are fair market value in this city's council to transfer title to the JCRA, so let them JCRA give to them designate to develop for, I think it's not fair to people of Jersey City. Any property city owned actually belongs to the people of Jersey City. So that's the way they helped the special developer to develop in that area, I think, like a special treatment. I feel very uncomfortable. These things you should be stopping. If any property owned by city, when they sell it, they should be sold by public auction. So I would know.
Councilperson Osborne?
Aye.
Councilperson Coleman?
I would just like to say that these properties are in the middle of a lot of other land that belongs to the Jersey City Redevelopment Agency already. And if it was sold by public auction, it would be sold to maybe different individual people who would buy it, and the land would go undeveloped because a project could not be built with those two pieces of property in the middle. So it's better to sell it at market value, have it appraised, and let let the developer pay the price, and that price comes to the city. And with that, I vote aye. Thank you,
Ben. Councilperson Rivera?
Vote aye.
Waterman?
Aye.
President?
Aye.
We have an 8-1 vote. Councilperson Yun voting no for the final adoption of item 4J, City Ordinance 16-010. 16-011 is item 4K. It's an ordinance approving a 20-year tax exemption for a market-rate mixed-use rental project to be constructed by 305 West Side Urban Renewal LLC, an urban renewal entity, pursuant to the long-term tax exemption law, New Jersey statutes annotated 40A:20-1 et sec. Mrs. Balser.
Yes, before I go into the money issue, I'd like to know, is there one-to-one parking for this new development or not?
No.
No.
No, it's not. So what parking do you have there for that new development?
I don't have a site plan.
19 parking spaces.
How many?
39 units apartment, but there were 19 parking space.
19. Well, no, the,
so
the
you have 39. Go ahead. Right. You may tell me.
Yes, Charles Harrington of Connell Foley on behalf of the developer here. The project has 19 parking spaces, 39 residential units. It is located right down the street from the West Side Avenue Light Rail Station. So that it does, you know, meet the requirements of the parking. And it does have a small, about 3,700 square foot of retail space that fronts along West Side Avenue.
You know, I'm very happy that it is near the light rail. But just because it is near the light rail does not mean the person, doctor, is located near the light rail, because my doctor is not near the light rail at all. So the idea is another example of you, this being a nanny city, who's saying that you should not have a car because we have decided you should not have a car. But in reality, when my son turned, I don't know, when he was got his license, he was still living in a house. The first thing he did was get a car. And he was living at home. People buy cars. So what you're doing, in effect, is making an area like downtown or Journal Square, you're putting in people there with cars and taking it away from people that normally would be there. Because the old homes, as you know, did not have parking with them. And you're making an area very uncomfortable for the people. And they're in for a wake-up call. The light rail is very limited line. It is not the New York City subway. It goes specific routes. It does not cover the city. It is very minute. So to say that's the case is ridiculous. You're making life harder for the accumulation. You took away a lot of parking spaces today, and now you're putting in development without the light rail. I mean, without adequate parking. People will have cars. You cannot shop or go on vacation or go to the doctor. This is not the 1940s and 50s where everything was located like within one small area. It's not that way anymore, and I think it's absolutely foolish for the city to do this when everyone up there still use your car. In fact, I saw at the end of I'm not going to go into that, but every one of you still use your car to get around, and those individuals will have your cars too. Now, in terms of this, I think the 20-year tax abatement for market rate mixed use is wrong. The city last month sold liens to regular 1-4 homeowners that did not have tax abatement, and they went into lien. And the reason why they're going to lien is because their taxes are so high, because they're subsidizing everybody else. And I think if you're going to fix something, you should fix the people that already own homes and are losing them, because this does not help them at all. You're just giving a break to somebody new for 20 years, and you're creating a thing where you're stealing from Peter to pay Paul. And I think that's absolutely wrong. Because there's many people, when I looked at the list on the liens, a lot of them were in Ward A and Ward F that are losing their homes. And that does not help the people in Ward A and Ward F. It would help the people in Ward A and Ward F if this was a rateable. Once it was a rateable, then the tax rate would go down because the rateable base would go up. So what you're doing right now, you're hurting the long-term homeowner by giving out this abatement to regular taxpayers. But the thing about the parking really, I have to say, really gets to me. Thank you very much. And I'd like to see all of you give up your cars, too. Thank you.
I would.
I don't come here very often. I came here tonight for a very specific reason, but I've known Yvonne off and on for about 35 years. My name's Rosalie Narciso. And I don't come here often, so I don't know what goes on. And I'm interested to see that this tax abatement business has gone on and on and on and on. And I think you people get a little deaf to Yvonne because she comes here every week and she talks, and I don't think you pay attention. I think you think she just talks for herself, and I think you're wrong. I'd like to know where my tax abatement is. I pay more in tax than my grandparents paid for the house. If the new reval goes through, I probably won't be able to afford to stay here anymore.
So I need you to speak on this ordinance.
Back to the ordinance. I don't think you should be giving out abatements, and I really think it's got to stop. I mean, that was one of the things that Philip complained about when he was a councilman, the abatements. And the question is, where is my abatement? It's real simple. I'll speak about this later. Thank you.
The public hearing on this ordinance. Anyone else wishing to be heard?
Jason Berg. The real problem with city development or development as a whole is working on the realm of sustainability.
This ordinance, holistic.
No, well you got it.
Specific.
Well,
shotgun.
Not having enough space to park is like putting out a fire with a sieve. You're not thinking forward, you're thinking now. You're thinking to the abatements, filling your coffers. And the real thing here is, what's going to happen when the people start getting smart and start saying that you don't have to pay taxes because all the property that has been possessed by the United States of America and its counties and states has been stolen from Native American Indians? There's a point. But the real thing here is that, please, when you do something, give someone an abatement. I'm a homeowner. My family's been here since 1946 in the South Ward, Ward A. And the real thing here is that I'll second that other speaker's thought. Where is my abatement? I mean, this council ran on no abatements, and every time you turn around, it's like, let's give abatement. Okay. Guys, please use your mind, use your sense. You have vision. You're all educated people with college degrees. And if you keep on passing this stuff, we don't have the infrastructure. Every time we build a new building, you're putting more challenge on our infrastructure, the sewer system, our water system. Please, you know, use a God-given sense, common sense, which is not common in today's world. Thank you very much.
Okay, but can I ask one question?
Can we finish the public hearing?
Yeah.
Let's conduct and close the public hearing. Anyone else wishing to be heard?
Motion.
Second.
We have a motion by Councilperson Ramchal, seconded by the Council President. Close the public hearing. Councilperson Gajewski.
Aye.
Ramchal.
Aye.
Bagiano.
Aye.
Yun.
Aye.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera. Waterman.
Aye.
Council President.
Hi.
All right, we've closed the public hearing.
Okay, let's open it up to discussion.
First, yes.
Councilman Ramchal.
Okay.
So I will ask my colleague, and I just want to let you guys know, and Yvonne, this project is not in Ward A. It's in Ward B. And what's there right now, it's a dumping ground. Since I took office, all I get phone call, I think the city spent a lot of money cleaning up the property. Because every week there is phone call coming, there is debris. Not myself, Councilman Gajewski is aware. Mm-hmm. Because people, it's the borderline of A and B, but it's right across to the Social Security office. So it's technically, it's Ward B. I know back in the days when Dave Donnelly was a councilman, I set a meeting with him. Nobody wanted to develop there. Finally, we got a developer that we met with and want to develop on this property. And that's the abatement policy. He allowed to have 20 years there. And I didn't run on no abatement. I welcome development in my ward, and I would love to give abatement in my ward just as well that they give downtown. Nothing against Councilwoman Osborne, but my ward need development, and this development is good for my ward, and I want to thank the developer that, you know, to take this property and develop on it, because right now it's a dumping ground. And thank you guys, and I ask my colleague, please support this this abatement.
Okay,
can I?
Councilman Yun?
Yes, thank you. Can I have a representative for this project or developer is here?
Is the developer representative available?
Yeah, yeah.
We have Charles Harrington.
Actually, I hope the public aware that this issue. This is a very, very strange tax abatement they require and they ask to City Council. This area, based on, you know, mayor's tax abatement policy, Ivan, I'd like you to pay attention a little bit more. This one, they can ask, as I say, based on
policy,
tax abatement policy, mayor's policy, they can ask 30 years, 30 years tax abatement, and they only pay 10% of annual gross revenue for the annual service charge. But this application ordinance, they only 20%, less than 10% they can ask, and the annual service charge, they can pay 10%, but they're willing to pay 12%. So actually, when I read this ordinance, I scratch my head. If normal developer in Jersey City, they ask or extend the term, and they try to pay a low annual service charge. But this is the only one I see. They want shorter term, and they're willing to pay more. So now, I'm asking you why you ask shorter term and pay more annual service charge.
Can I respond to that?
Yeah.
It's actually not a request. It was negotiated down because the financials, when the city did its due diligence on it, they wanted to make sure that those numbers worked for the city of Jersey City. And so 30 years, that area is zoned for that, and according to the abatement policy. But we still vote on things here, and I think it's the council has made it clear that we're not taking a loss on abatements. We want to cover our fiscal costs and impacts, and so these kind of arrangements are negotiated as well, and we have the flexibility to do that as well inside of the abatement policy, which is a policy and a guiding principle in which to kind of approach these things. And I'll let
just to add to Council President's comments, where the initial application for the abatement here was for 30 years,
mm-hmm.
because under the new policy, it is a 30-year zone. But when the administration did their due diligence and their fiscal impact analysis, it turned out to be a loss for the city,
mm-hmm.
over the term of the abatement. So they contacted me and said, well, that can't work. Maybe on a larger project, a 30-year, you know, may work, but not on this one. So the fiscal impact analysis done by the city resulted in us in looking at this again, and we amended our application for a 20-year abatement and at a 12% of the annual gross revenue, as opposed to the 11% was the initial application consistent with the policy. So it was a result of the review by the city and advising us that.
Because of that, what you pay, what city of just provide, the cost of universal service is not matched. That's why you make a short term and more annual service charge. Still, 20 years and the 12%, what you guys, that project, pay annual service charge to City of Jersey City barely cover cost of municipal services what we provide. You know, even though we give you those things that they are taxable 20 years, 12% of annual service charge, still, benefit to City of Jersey City is $32 a year. You know, so already they clear 20 years and it's too long, 12% it's not, number is not big enough. You know, that tells you very clear, you know what I'm saying? So that's what I'm asking you, that's all, nothing more than that, okay?
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
Are we supposed to be voting? Are we supposed
to
be
voting? Yeah, we should be.
You have a comment?
Voting.
Yeah, we're going to vote. Okay.
Start from the top with Councilperson Gajewski.
Roll call.
Councilperson Gajewski.
It's all about downtown.
Thank you, Councilperson Gajewski. Councilperson Ramchal.
Well, I said my piece before, and all I can say again, Chuck, thank you for your hard work. You know, communication key. Well done. And Frank, Councilman Gajewski as well. We talked about this. We work on this together. And like I said to my colleague, this is a great project for my ward. It's nothing but a dumping ground there right now. And I welcome development on the west side. And again, thank you. With that, I vote aye.
Councilperson Baggiano.
Is it being developed because it's so close to the light rail and that's why the area is getting development? That's number one. And then what Yvonne brought up tonight brings up another argument. Before we were arguing about the years, tax abatements, 30 years. Now we're talking about cars. I think we have to start reconsidering this attitude that they can put up these, like the building in Journal Square, which is going to have 1,800 units. Between the three of them with 800 parking spaces. It's ridiculous because PATH is in back of the station. We have to start changing our attitude. I'm going to vote aye for one reason, because Chico and Franny think it's going to do great for their neighborhood. But let's remember, light rail is right there. That's the reason for the development coming there. And there's going to be a lot of development. And the developers are making money, and we're paying for it as homeowners in the city.
Councilperson Yun.
Well, 305 West Side Avenue, that location really bad condition, that I agree with you. And the similar things happen my district, corner of Summit Avenue and the Patterson Prank Road, really. The entrance of the our district really was terrible. After that, you know, they build affordable housing, middle income, and that looks great. And this one, I can say that first things, That Corporation Council Jeremy and there was the developer the negotiating lower the 30 years to 20 years, and the annual surcharge 10% to increase to 12%, and I believe that that location deserved to have a tax abatement to improve. So I vote for aye. But as a councilman Richie Bojano said, not because they build because tax abatement. because of bill, the demand that they have, you know. So I vote for I as a special treatment to that area and they show to them West Side Avenue improvement that they deserve to have. But we have to be understand, if we give to the every tax abatement, the long-term tax, 20 years, very long-term tax to every district, then who's going to pay school tax? Who's going to pay rest of the county tax? That is the issue. If the way they say tax abatement is good, then give to us every taxpayer city of Georgia City. But I vote for I because that location is deserved to have tax abatement to improve that area. But other than that, 20 years are too long, probably maximum 15 years of tax abatement is a little acceptable for certain area.
You voted aye. Councilperson Osborne?
Aye.
Coleman?
Congratulations, guys, on a project in a horrible area. Mm-hmm. I like to see the rest of our city being built up. That's a wonderful thing, and I vote aye.
Thank you, Councilwoman.
Councilperson Rivera?
Aye.
Waterman?
Congratulations, guys. I vote aye.
Thank you.
Council President?
So I live in the area, so it's not that bad. I live up the block from there, so it's but that property, that property, that lot is been fallow, and it's an eyesore for a long time. For those old timers, it was the old Max Video over there, and after Max Video left, there's been nothing there. It's just been an eyesore for a very, very long time. I will also add that there's the power stations right there, right?
Yeah.
So in order to attract development as well, I would say there is definitely a need for some sort of incentive, because that power station is not exactly an attractive neighbor for the developer over there. And then I had one other point I wanted to make. Last thing I wanted to say was, this redevelopment area. I remember several years ago, under Healy's administration, as we were going through this, changes in the redevelopment plan, how it had been decades that redevelopment plan was in place, and how little development had come to the area. And so they were fighting to make more changes to the redevelopment plan to make it more attractive and incentivize it for development in that sense. And so this is in part fruition of that, I would say. That was the changes that were necessary to make. And you'll see a lot of different projects that are coming up over there, and we've seen a number of different development going on there, and this is going to be a great addition, along with the work that NJCU's and the West Campus development is going to bring to that area as well. I vote aye.
And I added to the council president mentioned to that, actually, normal developer are not going to get in that lot because of power station, really.
Right.
You know, that has a major, my concern was that when I look at Google it, you know, but this developer willing to stand up to build, and some part of that, I said thank you, and I'll support that idea, you know. So good luck. And this is the first one I give, say, aye for long-term tax abatement. Don't forget.
Can only vote once on an ordinance.
Thank you, Councilman.
We have a 9-0 vote for the adoption of City Ordinance 16-011, Item 4K. I know that we're not going to conduct the public hearing on 4L-16012. That's the ordinance amending the traffic code regarding parking facilities operated by the Parking Division of Parking Enforcement.
Motion
so
to table.
I need a motion by the Council President, seconded by Councilperson Ramchal. This is to table Item 4L-16012 prior to the close of the public hearing. Councilperson Gajewski. Ramchal.
Aye.
Bagiano.
Aye.
Yun.
Aye.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera.
Aye.
Waterman.
Aye.
Lavaro.
Yeah, just very quickly for the viewing public, tabling this is an effort to eliminate first offense booting. Haven't been able to find an enforcement mechanism that works to get this done. Not giving up on it, on the idea that first offense booting, eliminating that somehow, but still want to make sure that have the deterrent and enforcement in place. So I vote aye to table.
So it's tabled after the prior to the close of the public hearing. We're on to the speakers list.
Before we go to the regular speakers list, we have a customary to defer to elected officials. And we want to welcome the newest member of the New Jersey State Legislature, the Assemblywoman from District 31, who we want to welcome you here to the City Council, Assemblywoman. And congratulations on your swearing in.
Hello, I would like to officially introduce myself as Assemblywoman Angela V. McKnight, the first African-American woman to serve in the 31st District as Assembly. I come tonight before you on behalf of one of my constituents who came to me in regards to renaming of PS number 20 school to be named after President Barack Obama. While in office, our president has done great work regarding education reform. Number one, Every Student Succeeds Act. The act was signed on December the 10th, 2015, unlike the No Child Left Behind Act, which gives one size fit all for federal identifications and interventions. The Every Student Succeeds Act allows state development identifications and interventions with support from bottom 5% of schools. Schools where subgroups are falling behind and high schools' dropout rates are high. The Act further holds on students to high academic success, prepares all students for success in college careers, and more importantly, guaranteed steps are taken to help students and their schools improve. Secondly, Obama has made history being the only president to make a proposal where students would be able to attend a two-year college, community college, for free. President Obama recently stated, and I quote, "Providing 2 years of community college at no cost for every responsible student is one of the best ways to do that, and I'm going to keep fighting to get that started this year. It's the right thing to do," close quote. In addition, the Healthy Hunger-Free Kids Act inception, the program has expanded, serving more than 1 million students across the United States, not only lunch, but dinner too, as part of its after-school program snack offering. Lastly, I would like to thank Councilman Jujewski, also President Lavaro, Council President Lavaro, for their support. I am asking the rest of the council members for their support in renaming the school after President Barack Obama. The next step I will do is to follow the proper protocols with this Board of Education to get all the information needed to pursue this renaming of PS22 school. Thank you.
Welcome. Thank you, Assemblywoman.
Welcome, Angela.
Would anyone like to comment to the Assemblywoman?
Yes, Assemblywoman McKnight, you have my full support, and I think you know that already.
Thank you.
My only question was, you answered it already, mm-hmm. Contacting the Board of Education, because it's a school and you got to go through proper protocol. But I think, you know, it's a great idea, and you should take whoever brought this idea up to you, take them as well to Board of Ed. Mm-hmm. And I would gladly recommend Councilwoman Lord Joyce Waterman and co-sponsored by Councilwoman Coleman, this legislation.
Well, I think it's
great. I thought the Joyce Waterman doesn't get the job.
It's in Ward A.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, there you go. There you go. I'm sorry.
Well, do you get the job?
Frank is going to put it over there. Mm-hmm. Don't take yourself off.
Well, thank you.
Tell me, woman, recent,
yeah.
We came up with so many obstacles, believe it or not, and it wasn't, do you hear me now?
I hear
Okay. I just want to suggest to the Assemblywoman that when it comes to naming any building, that you always get the community to support you, too. And the reason why I said that, because when we named the West Precinct after Melvin Santiago, we did found resistance. And sometimes people do such a great thing in our country that we do want to honor them. And so I'm just suggesting to you, so this won't be such a battle, because I do agree that we should name 20 School after our president, because he has done great things. So I would suggest that you start meeting with the community and start getting their full support. And sure, I know my colleagues, we will agree to co-sponsor, and it is Frank Ward, a resolution. And Frank, you can head the resolution, and it will look really good that Frank had the resolution, and all of us will definitely sign it.
Yes, and that's why I came here tonight, to, you know, to respect the process. So I will have some community meetings. I will again reach out to Frank and do whatever else I need to do to get the community involvement. I totally understand. So I thank you all.
Whatever you need from me, you know where to find me. I'm there for you, so don't worry about that. And to my colleague, I'm sorry, I thought it was in Ward F. So.
No, that's okay. They're neighbors.
Yeah, so we are neighbors. So.
Let me just
State Farm is here.
Let me just add that I'd be happy to support and put a resolution from the council, sponsored by Frank and anyone else on the council who wants to sponsor that. But I just wanted to add that this is the first time an assembly person has come to speak and request and support or assistance from the council in two years that we've been here. And probably in 4 years since I've been here. And so I applaud you for that. That's a big deal. So thank you so much for looking forward to the partnership over the next 2 years as you're in office and beyond, obviously. Thank you, Assemblywoman.
Thank you, Assemblywoman.
Thank you.
Romuald Diswokan? Not here.
No.
John Seborowski? Not here. Yvonne, starting us off tonight. Dan Peston already spoke.
I just want to say, Yvonne Balser, that I'm glad you told me where that property is at. Several years ago, when my mother passed away, I had to go to Social Security for her, and there was no parking in the area. I know where that property is at. And I thought to myself, why didn't Social Security buy that piece of property for a parking lot? Because it is right next to a power station, and who wants to live next to that? I mean, I wouldn't. That is a perfect spot for a parking lot for the city, not housing, because right now you're putting in more housing in which people who are going in there is no parking from Social Security. My husband and I had to park the car like four blocks away. Now that you're putting in housing there, you're talking about 19 or 20 more cars that is not going to be parked. It's going to be parked on the street. It's absolutely the worst thing I've heard right now, because you probably do not realize how crowded it is around Social Security, because you didn't go there. I had to go for my mother, and I know how crowded it was. And we had to park four blocks because there was no parking there at all. And I'm saying to myself, that's a perfect spot. Why didn't Social Security buy it? So, no, I'm absolutely against the idea of putting housing in an area, especially next to a power station. But tonight is my night to talk about parking. Last night at the Wardian meeting, many people were upset by parking, and I've actually told the councilwoman Waterman, that I have the solution. In my own building, we don't charge people for parking. It is free. So every person parks their cars inside the garage. No one is outside or on the street. Now, when you go downtown, people don't want to park inside the garage because they're charging $500 to park there. So what will they do? They're going to park on the street. So you have citizens there saying, oh, we got to do something. Well, no. We're allowing these developers to rip off the public. So, and it's a two-way street. You're hurting the people who live in brownstones or row houses that don't have parking because those houses are built. It was horse and carriage. There was no parking. So now you're putting in how you're allowing them to get away with murder. Next door to me is a guy who lives in a studio, and guess what? He has a parking area just like I have a parking area. We don't discriminate that someone lives in a studio and someone lives in a two-bedroom, that one can have parking and one cannot have parking. This discrimination is what it's all about. So if you want to solve the problem of the city, require, like you require kitchens, require everyone to have parking and don't charge them for that. Because my building, the reason why I had to leave downtown, my husband, you know, is up in age. I was not going to have him shoveling snow anymore because we lost our parking 20 years ago when that particular building became a condo when we had parking there. I think it's absolutely wrong what is happening with parking. It is no quality of life at all. It's really phony on the city side to say, oh, well, people, we live in an urban area. I grew up in Hoboken. And I came here when I was married to my husband in my early 20s. There was more mass transit then than there is now. There was all types of buses coming into the city and going throughout the city. Those buses do not exist anymore. And the light rail is very finite. And I have to say one thing. The light rail is not next to that property you're talking about near Social Security. It's further. It's not that close at all. So if you're handicapped and whatnot, that's a heck of a walk. And you have a lot of senior citizens inside Social Security. I remember seeing them in there. I was wondering how they got in there. So, I mean, this whole issue of parking and the city saying that we don't need parking and we got, and because we are urban area, it's baloney. You're causing stress on people's lives. And I never forgot the day that we had people come here saying in Ward B area, near St. Peter's College, how they were fighting over minuscule parking. And their solution was, well, we should have permit parking. No, we have to require parking. We have to stop the city putting in buildings on parking lots like what you did in the courthouse. And that parking lot that I used to use when I went to school 11 is now going to have a building on. And all the other parents who went to school 11 through the Board of Ed meeting would park in the municipal parking lot right there. They would park there. I mean, it is a nanny state here telling us we should not have parking while all of you still have parking. I find it's the worst thing in this city, with the exception of taxes, is how you're getting rid of parking and saying we don't need an urban area, we need bikes. I'm sorry, I'll be 70 soon and I don't need a bike. I need a place to park my car.
Thank you.
Jeremy.
Is that possible? So, like in some of the high rises downtown that do have parking, and I think Yvonne's right that there are people who are not parking in the building, they're parking on the streets. It's pretty obvious. Is it possible for us to require the building to provide that parking for free for the residents of the building?
So first I would say if the building has parking, then technically the people who live in that building aren't able to get parking permits to park on the street. So that's one way we address that. In new buildings going forward, we could figure out a mechanism to require parking to either be deeded in a condo situation or to be tied to the rent in a rental situation. For buildings that are already existing, it's very hard to change the arrangement because they've already got all their approvals, they've got their CO, so you would have tied it in with their site plan approval.
Okay, so if we were doing it, it would need to be part of site plan approvals.
Yeah, we would do it as part of the site plan approval.
But not for existing buildings.
But existing buildings, that would be a hard thing to change.
Okay, thanks.
So we can do it though.
And if you want to make that change for buildings going forward, that's something you've got to start by talking to planning and then get the planning board to figure out. And the real thing to do would be to put it as part of all of our redevelopment plans as well.
I see. Okay.
Rosalie Narciso.
Hi, you'll have to excuse me. I'm kind of a novice at this. I want to go back quickly to the abatements. I think they used to have senior citizen deductions on the tax bills. I don't know if you still have them. And if you do, have you ever reviewed the income limitations, which the last time I heard was like $10,000 a year?
Yes.
Said by the state. So basically, it's if you have rental income, it's useless.
What I would want to say just about that, first off, is we have looked at this, and Joyce Waterman has been a champion in this area, along with Diane Coleman, to try and get the state to change those numbers, increase the income allotment, and increase the deduction amount. But unfortunately, it is within the state's jurisdiction, not ours.
We've given it to the assemblywoman. We did it here, and we've given it to the assemblywoman to take down to the state to try to champion to change that.
Okay.
We did
Thank
that.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Because it's useless. I basically came here to address, I want to thank Councilman Lavero, because he's tried twice to put me in touch with Candace Osborne, and I think it's easier to get in touch with Barack Obama, I'll be frank. I've written your office, I've gone to your office, Lavero twice contacted you, your secretary called me about 2 weeks ago, I returned the phone call, she never returned the phone call.
Okay, yeah, I asked, just so you know, I specifically asked her to reach out to you. Okay, but go ahead.
This is not how you run an office. You return phone calls, you answer letters, you don't pass everything on to the residence response bureau.
Absolutely.
That's what you did, basically. I live on 3rd Street. I have a service alleyway behind my house. It's gone back and forth as to who owns it.
Yep.
I believe it is not owned by the people whose houses it's behind. What we need to do is we need to get the law department here, the real estate department in here.
Hold on 1 second. Jeremy, can you come here? Sorry, I want you to hear what she's saying.
Time. I need an answer. It needs to be serviced. You've serviced it for years. You've plowed it for years. You've put black tack. You put rock. We need rock. We need the one end straightened out. And now everybody says it's not ours, it's not ours, it's not ours. These houses were built in the 1800s. I see in this thing that you can dedicate property back to the city. Why can't we just give it back to you? I don't think we own it. My property's only 95 feet deep. The property behind me is 95 feet deep. 10 feet goes into the alleyway. I don't own it. I need someone to come. I need this followed up on. The second thing I want to speak about real quickly is the lack of senior services in this city. It is absolutely abysmal. I go to everything in Sea Caucus. You have a website. How many 80-year-old seniors have computers? You have to go on the website to find this. Sea Caucus gives out a calendar. It's all over the city. They mail it to their residents. Where's ours? What is the senior department doing? I don't need a bus ride to Atlantic City. I don't need a ride to the ShopRite. We don't have centralized senior services here. Get one of these developers to build a large, dedicated senior center for everybody in the city. We've been neglected. How many senior buildings are you putting up? How many? Are we putting up any senior buildings? Two new ones. All right. Okay. I mean, but I met a guy here who just got a job doing outreach for some cultural thing. Who's doing outreach to seniors in this city? Who is? You think buying a bus to take us to the ShopRite's enough? That's not enough. I want to be able to go to museums. I want to be able to go to Broadway shows. Goya gave two dinners for Sea Caucus seniors. What's Goya done in Jersey City so far?
None.
Yeah. So, and how much money did we give them to move to Jersey City? And then Healy said he brought 300 jobs to Jersey City.
That's not the truth.
He didn't bring any jobs to Jersey City. He brought 300 jobs from Sea Caucus to Jersey City. You people are sitting up there, and you're not paying attention. You're not paying attention, and you're not going to get reelected.
Thank you. Steve Hyman is not here. Jason Berg, you finish us off tonight.
Rosalie, Councilperson Osborne? Yeah? Were you? Okay. Rosalie, Councilperson Osborne is coming to you.
Go ahead, Jason.
My time starts when I speak there, Robert, not before.
Well, your time starts now. Go.
Thank you very much. I have three different forms. One is from the tax office. Well, I'm glad something gets itchy. I hope it's not the ball trees.
That was classic.
Yeah, well, it wasn't. I miss your sarcasm. This is to the Hudson County assessor. Please be advised that the recording of titles of real estate under fee sample or land patents, absent clear and unambiguous evidence of constitutional extinguishment of Indian titles, is a violation of Title USC 151. A federal law protects the tribal rights of tribal land and soil under the Ex parte Youth Doctrine 209 U.S. 123, 1908. State officials can be sued to prevent them from violating the right of protecting by federal land, federal law, excuse me. The general vitae of the Ex parte has been affirmed in the United States Supreme Court in Fairley X. Fee versus Hawkins, 504 U.S. 431, 2004, and so on and so forth. Again, I talk about sustainability. You're going to lose it because the taxes and property are owned by the Indians and not by the American usurpers. Another thing is statutes, acts, ordinances are not laws. I'm submitting it to you, and I'll have copies for the council for that. All right? They are not laws. They are legislative rules of society. Legislative rules of society are given force through law. Law precedes right rules. Maxim of law. Government can only control what it creates. The power which is derived cannot be greater than from which it was derived from. U.S. Constitutional Article 6, Clause 2, Supremacy Clause of the United States Constitution. This Constitution of the laws of the United States, which will be made in pursuant, therefore, and all treaties made of which shall be made under the authority of the United States, shall be the supreme law of the land, and the judges of every state shall be bound thereby. Anything in the Constitution of the laws of any state that is contrary, notwithstanding, which means that all laws made after the Constitution law, like your privileges to drive, is a violation. You cannot take someone's inalienable rights from the Constitution and pervert it into a privilege. Another document was sent out by National Liberty Alliance, by the United States Common Law Grand Jury, and in it indicts against all the governors, all senators, and even the Supreme Court for violations of the people. We the people, everyone here in the front of me and the back of me are being victimized. Anyone who speaks about their rights is now considered a terrorist under the FBI's sovereign citizens. There is no such thing as a sovereign citizen. And I was part of National Liberty Alliance, had been called on an alert which caused me to be attacked on March 24, 2015, for taking a Homeland Security vehicle photograph. I am a news reporter for the Pacifica News Service, and I had my First Amendment rights violated. And every time that these rights are violated, we're losing some more. This United States of America is a republic, and anyone who says that it's a democracy is wrong. There's nothing in the Constitution that says that it is a democracy. In the Pledge of Allegiance to the Flag, so it says, for the Republic for which it stands. It doesn't say
Republic, to the Republic.
To the Republic. Well, it doesn't say to the democracy, which 51% gets it and the 49% are losers. And if it's a democracy, then the majority rules, and we can all vote ourselves a tax deduction. And now we have the attack on the Bundy group, who are traveling on a public road by FBI agents for doing illicit things. The thing is that anyone can call you anything, and the bottom line here is we are not terrorists. We are all here, and we are here to do our job. And when you take an oath of office, young men and women, the policemen, you and you use statutes, you are in violation of the color law, and you are in violation. Thank you very much. I still got a little time. This would be a little factor, a little two. Thank you so much to be here with you, and this is time to be done. If you don't take action, don't blame yourself. Night. Don't blame others. Blame you. Thank you.
Sound of good night to you.
Thank you. I miss you so much, Robert.
I missed you with every shot so far. Petitions and communications, items 6A through 6Z. We have no officers' communications nor reports of directors where the claims in addendum number one. Councilperson Gajewski. Ramcha. Bajiano. Yun.
Aye.
Osborne.
She stepped away.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera. Aye. Waterman.
Black.
Lavara.
Aye.
Blackery.
Jeremy, would you let Councilwoman Jeremy know they're voting? Wait, I'm busy. Busy. Oh. We're going to vote on resolutions and adjourn this meeting if she doesn't come back. 10A through 10M, Councilperson Gajewski. Ramchal.
Aye.
Bajiano.
Aye.
Yun.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera?
Aye.
Waterman?
She stepped away.
No.
Aye. Oh, Candace said aye.
Well, the girl's gone.
Council President on 10A through M. I'm sorry, sir.
Aye.
We have Councilperson Waterman out, too. Let them know that we're about to adjourn.
I just want to say thank you to the New Jersey Devils for the program that they're bringing here to Jersey City. I vote aye.
Councilperson Waterman, 10A through M. We need your vote on the claims and addendum number one.
Oh, claims and addendums.
For Councilperson
Get the Waterman. Devils thing.
Councilperson Waterman.
Aye.
10A through M, Councilperson Waterman.
Aye.
N through V, Councilperson Gajewski. Ramchal.
Aye.
Bajiano. Yun.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera. Waterman.
Aye.
Lavara. Yeah.
Okay. We're doing resolutions, right?
Yes.
Aye.
N through V. Balance of business, W through Z.
Before we proceed with that vote.
1 through Z4 earlier. This evening, yes, Council President.
We have a 10X, Brian 10X, Platt is here to speak on that. We didn't have you at the caucus meeting. Some council members had questions.
Bring your handsome face up to the podium.
You can just explain what's going on in 10X, and then maybe that'll answer some of the questions.
Brian Platt for the public record. Just an overview of what we're doing?
Yep.
Sure. So we are hiring a consultant to review and provide recommendations to improve and streamline the permitting and licensing process for businesses. That's the focus of what this work would be. So it's kind of two phases. The first phase is an analysis and understanding of what this process looks like. And I think that we think that it is much more work than just one person or two people can handle. Even our team, it's a full-time job. They're going to bring probably three or four people to think about this and understand it from start to finish. And it doesn't matter what kind of permit it is. It could be a sidewalk cafe. It could be, you know, a construction permit. Anything that involves opening or maintaining a business. Once we get a better understanding of what that process looks like, any type of process, they will provide us with recommendations as to how to improve and streamline it. And the reason why we want to do this before we even think about any kind of, our ultimate goal is to have an online automated process that walks you through this without question as to what's happening. So,
does that include temporary permitting?
What's that?
Does that include temporary permitting, like one-day permit for a tent or, you know, that kind of stuff? Does that include that?
This is going to focus on just brick-and-mortar business, construction permits, and any kind of licensing that's related to a business.
And brick-and-mortar.
If you're, okay. Yeah, so if you know, the event permits for special events and for activities and that kind of stuff, we assume that there will be some benefit seen by that process, just because the goal of this is to have, as I was saying before, an electronic automated process. So you go to a single website, you click, I want to, you know, I'm starting a business or I have a business and I want this thing. And it walks you through the process each step of the way. One thing that we've noticed already that's missing is that, you know, none of the agencies really talk to each other or are communicating with the business directly. So, you know, let's say you're opening a restaurant, you know, you have to go to Commerce for your sidewalk cafe license and you have to go to the health department for your food license, but already. They don't necessarily communicate with each other throughout the whole process. Yes.
It was already streamlined supposedly last year.
That's what we thought anyway.
Which one?
Get a one-stop shop.
What part of it?
All of that.
What you explained to us.
Everything you're talking about.
So.
Special events we're talking about?
Not special events. Nothing to do with special events. Nothing special events. So I think, you know, if you talk to small businesses, one of their big complaints, and we've done a lot of this, we've done a lot of outreach to them, and they communicate with us very regularly about the issues they have. And so one of the hang-ups is that they get stuck trying to get all their permits done. And there's a communication gap. There's an issue in the permitting process itself. But the big piece is that there's no single place to fill out all this information. So what we envision is a tool, an electronic tool, online tool that does all this paperwork for you in an automated way, which we do not have today. Right now you go to construction code and you fill out papers, and you go to health and you fill out other papers, and you go to commerce and you fill out other papers. That is not the case today. And if you can show me that process, I would love to see it. But we talk to businesses all the time and we don't see it.
Okay, Brian?
Yeah.
Thank you for your effort to pay more attention to small business in our community to open the business judges are encouraged to. But now let me ask you this. We're going to pay $195,000. It's almost like we're going to pay $200,000 hire consulting company tell us what is the wrong, or they're going to come up $200,000 come up plan and the software or digital program, you know what I'm saying? See, that's why I'm wondering what we're going to pay $200,000. We're going to pay $200,000 for program, in other words, software and maintenance, or we just pay $200,000 consult company
for what?
That's what's our product? You know, yeah, so because we all know the problem what we have.
Yes. First of all, you are not paying for any of this. This is all funded through the grant, so it's not taxpayer dollars that we're spending right now. And then we have allocated already within our own budget funding for the actual software program that would be implemented.
Okay, now let me make the second question is that this is for just a business license issue, permitting issue, or they include building, construction, what is it?
Yes, all of the above.
Yeah, so
all include.
Our goal is to address business licensing and permitting. However, there will be a benefit to residences and anyone who has to go through any construction permitting process, because it's all the same, and it should be all the same. It doesn't matter if it's a business or a house. Construction is construction.
You know why we questioned it? Because we had a meeting in the beginning that all of it, a caucus meeting, that this was being taken care of.
Yeah,
concerning the building department, that it would be, they was creating one-stop shop.
That's
so
what they were
not,
looking
not
to,
with
right?
Culture fairs, but I mean with buildings, because we
Kane.
Talked about it.
Elizabeth Kane.
I did come to the caucus in November when we first started the process.
Yeah, but this is
to
it.
Approve the
competitive contracting
for this RFP, which was, it took us a little while to get everything squared away. So that's maybe what you're thinking of.
So just so I want to make sure, before we approve the $200,000 consulting company, you know what I'm saying, doesn't matter if it's a Bloomberg's money or somebody else's money, it's money is money. But that consulting company provide, number one, for the business licensing permitting. Number two, the major concern is that they are building permit processing, you know what I'm saying, construction, that also include.
Right.
Yes.
But
absolutely.
They only give us that written report, not actual, not bring up the programs or software. It's not. Just
We'll get a report, a recommendation, is that?
Yes.
That's what it is?
So it needs to be separate because the skills and knowledge required to analyze the process is much different than the technology expertise to build the software program.
So now, we pay $20,000. They recommend the A, B, C, the A to Z. But if they have a program is not available out there, then their recommendation go nowhere.
Right.
You understand?
So we do have funding allocated for the software program, but it's very important also that we understand and improve the process before we buy any software,
mm-hmm.
just so we're not trying to put a Band-Aid on a broken leg here and,
beautiful.
And just
yes.
make an electronic process out of something that doesn't work.
Yes, I like that you that we said, but let me finish this one then. That company, consulting company, going to be also provide the service, $200,000, include the select software or a program that's
yeah,
included
yeah, yeah.
too, right?
So, right. So, you know, adhering to public contract law, yes, they will not be able to respond to an RFP that we put out, but they will help us write the RFP and help us select the vendor and make sure that we choose the right one.
Okay. That's what I want to make sure, you know.
Hey, let me take him from the top.
Hold on. I have a question.
I'm sorry, Council President.
So the final output is a product, is what, a recommendation, a report?
Yeah.
And when can we expect that?
It's a two-part thing. So the output from this consultant is the report and kind of recommendation of and the specs for the tool and what we need to implement.
What's
here.
The delivery due date?
It's a few months. We don't know exactly because neither we nor they have all the information as to how things work. I mean, there's a lot of things we don't even know yet.
Yeah, but when you put your RFP, they have a deadline to provide the report.
Right.
Yes, that's what they're going to do. So we don't know how long it's going to take, but they are tasked with finding out every little piece of this puzzle and where they go, and then trying to put them in a better place.
I hope if
within a year, 6 months,
oh,
9 months.
No.
Yeah, 6 months, 4 to 6 in that range, hopefully less.
Brian, if this one come out really good, if we get the good result, it's going to be improved the municipal service a whole lot. You know, major complaint is the people, that's what it is, you know. When you do, they get the permit, or license, they're lost somewhere in Jersey City. And they travel Jersey City up and down, north and south, east and west. That really is what make a lot of people frustrating. I hope willing to invest $200,000, you know, and I support it, to come up really great idea and grow a program to really improve the municipal service itself, okay?
Absolutely.
And not only that, as I said, one of the lady mentioned to that, everything is, you know, digital, you know, internet is a very good idea, but also we have a lot of people don't have a computer in the home. There are a lot of seniors cannot use, you know, don't have a computer, but don't know how to use, you know what I'm saying? So not only that, they have some booklet that have available to those certain, you know, people who need it, you know? All right?
Absolutely.
Other than that, I'm fine.
Are there any interim steps to the final product, interim outputs or so forth?
So, you know, the first step is kind of an assessment and an understanding of what goes where and what everything, what a business needs to open and all the permits that are required. And, you know, one thing that we've been trying to understand throughout this whole process, we've been thinking about this for months, and there's still things that come up and businesses that come to us and they say, we're stuck at this point. We're not getting our permits approved. They keep telling us this thing. We don't know where to go. Who do we talk to next? And we're still learning. And so hopefully we will be able to understand what it is now
once
in the short
process.
Term and then identify what it should be.
What are your benchmarks? In other words, what the council president is trying to find out is if you write a grant and you get approved, you have to be able to say that in 3 months we're going to have this, in 4 months we're going to have that. We want to know what those benchmarks are and the timelines so that we can monitor and make sure that you get, is that's what you're looking for, right?
Absolutely.
That's what he's looking
for,
okay?
So we would request that we sit down with this company and just to ensure that we're not setting unfair expectations for them. You know, we can write whatever we want in the RFP and say we want something in 2 weeks, but until they come in and really assess the damage, we may not know how long it's going to take. So I will absolutely communicate to the entire council the timing of this, once we get a better idea of what they are telling us.
Brian, maybe you missed that meeting. This council, some council members very frustrating, you know, one of the issues. Those kind of things we heard as council members
right.
at the caucus meeting many, many times. Four times?
No,
not for you.
Not for you, Brian.
Four times, every time they put your new title and a new job in the city hall, they come up to city council. I'm not telling you lying, I'm telling the truth. Yes, my role is there as a so-and-so to improve the business community, open the business in Jersey City. My role is I'm going to create a one-stop shopping for small business community.
Yep.
Many, many times, yep. once they get in the job, they do something else.
Yeah.
I hope this time you do right.
I'm certain it will be right. So I'm just trying to find out how right it's going to be.
Right.
So,
oh, I'm sorry.
Public input. I'm guessing you don't know exactly when that's going to happen, but I couldn't stress that you're getting some public input in there.
Yep.
Business people themselves,
yep.
Builders, developers, yep. contractors, so forth.
So throughout our whole process, we have done a significant amount of public input on a lot of the things that we're thinking about and the challenges that businesses face. We have anecdotal evidence from businesses that have kind of we've been talking to through their process. So we have that for reference, but we will absolutely open it up to additional public input specifically relating to this.
Brian.
Great.
Brian, real quick.
Councilman Rivera, Councilman Boggiano.
So, Brian, this company comes in, sets up a structure, ready to go. Two-part question.
Yeah.
First one, who is going to now maintain this structure? Your department?
One of the initiatives we plan to roll out is an office of small business or office, some kind of single place that would manage this type of thing. Different from some of the other economic development stuff we have, specifically relating to a single phone number and a single email address that a small business can reach out to talk about specific issues.
One-stop shop.
Right. So
I know you've been hearing it a bunch.
Many times. Many, many times.
So the second, hey,
so the second part of the question is this then. So the departments that I guess we're having a problem with all these permits, you know, all these confusion. So is there, at what point in time does this structure go to this department and tell them, okay, this is the way to go? If that's not the case, then what happens to those people?
Well, thankfully, we have, before this process even started, brought on board a variety of stakeholders within city government to make sure that they're on board with this. And it seems as though we have buy-in from all the relevant divisions and department leaders. We don't expect that we're going to be changing the titles or roles of people or firing people. It's more streamlining the workflow that they manage and making sure that there's better communication between them and the applicants and throughout the entire process. So the applicant just has a better understanding of how it works.
You're going to have to implement a lot of training.
Right.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's a big part. That's why it's not we're not just buying something and just installing it at everyone's computers. I mean, there's a lot to understand and there's a lot to build and there's a lot of training. Absolutely.
Councilman Boggiano, do you have...
Brian, I just want to ask you a quick question. When you started this department, you received a $2 million grant from Bloomberg, right?
Yes.
How much of that is left?
How much what?
How much of that is left?
We have two more years of it left, so two-thirds of it is left.
But all the people you have hired there, you're telling me that $2 million is still around?
Two-thirds
of it.
Two-thirds of it's still around?
Just about, yeah.
$1.2 million.
Yeah,
$1.3 million.
So the grant was awarded in November of, or as it was in the winter of 2015. The winter of 2014. The team didn't start. The team didn't fully fill out until the summer. People started April. The first other hire besides myself started in April of 2015. And the grant is supposed to last us until the end of 2017. It's a three-year grant.
Okay, Jeremy, this is the most important part of the contract, the ordinance.
You have a question? Yeah. Sorry, yeah. Michael. Well, Councilperson Osborne.
So to me, a project like this, first of all, I agree, like 99% of all issues are communications issues. I mean, I just had a constituent here, and it was a communication issue, right? So, I mean, that's the vast majority of all issues. When whether it's putting in a software or redoing a process, the biggest mistake by far that is made is when people go in and just do a process and don't do the right amount of user research ahead of time. And I would strongly encourage when they come in to do observations of people and of the work environment and what's happening, you know, probably unannounced so that people, you know, are don't feel on the spot and they're just doing their normal day-to-day behavior, mm-hmm. Because that's where you'll uncover the true process issues. And I just couldn't underscore that enough. I mean, that piece will be whether this succeeds or fails is whether the process that's being followed today is truly understood. And otherwise, if that workflow analysis isn't done right, it'll definitely fail. And I don't believe it will fail with you. I just wanted to kind of offer that as like really focus on that point.
Got it.
And the Brian, you know, so term of the contract is 1 year.
Yeah.
And the total amount of the contract shall not exceed $195,000. So I see as a councilman over the, you know, past two and a half years, we all put in this word, and they come back a year later, oh, because your case complicated, so we like amend the contract, ask so more dollars. You know, that's what has happened. Lawyers, consulting company, that's the way they take up taxpayer dollars left and right. So I like to put in this word, their total project cost not more than $195,000. So the contractor were there, even though they delayed time, even though take more than 1 year, they can only can maximum $195,000. So not countries 1 year per project. This project cost not more than 190. I want you to amend their word. You know, when you put your RFP, I want you to make it clear. Okay, total project cost not more than one, whatever, you know what I'm saying?
Yep, yep.
So you protect the taxpayers' dollars.
Yep.
Okay, you're a smart guy, so I'm pretty sure you know how to play.
It's for the record, right?
Yes, for record, that's why I say you are very smart.
Councilman Ramshaw has the last word on this.
One more. Okay, Brian, thank you, great job. But,
thank you.
But, you heard from all of us here tonight, from my colleagues, we all have issue with this because we've been heard this many times. One-stop shop. Nothing happened yet. So we will hold you accountable for this.
Good.
And if you could, too, if you could update us with the process.
Sure.
And you,
sure.
6 months?
Yeah, I will absolutely send all of you updates well before 6 months. I think, you know, even a few weeks after they get started, we'll be able to have a better idea of the timing. Also, you know. What's that?
July 9th, it should be up and running.
Sorry, I can't.
July.
July 9th.
No, there's no way.
Yeah.
No, the workflow analysis.
You're not going to have a new process in place by July.
No.
You think?
Oh, I mean, I can update you in July. I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm not sure yet. I don't know.
Okay, all right. You just keep us updated with the process.
Yeah.
How you move on with it. Are you coming along with the process?
Yeah.
That's all. All right, because.
Brian.
Tied here. This thing.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Wait, one more.
Thank you.
All right.
I figured.
All right. I want to catch Council Person Osborne up on the claims and addendum number one.
Aye.
We have a 9-0 vote for the claims and addendum number one. Resolutions A through M.
Aye.
9-0 for A through M.
Sure they did. Yeah.
N through V.
Yeah.
Aye.
I didn't hear that.
Unanimously 9-0. The balance of business, which is W through Z. We did Z1 through Z4 earlier. Councilperson Gajewski. Ramshaw.
Aye.
Bagiano. Yun.
I vote for I, all, and X. Just a condition is that the term of is 1 year per project.
Councilperson Osborne?
Aye.
Coleman?
Aye.
Rivera? Waterman?
Aye.
Council President?
Aye.
All right.
Motion.
Wait. Let me get my time out here. To adjourn at exactly 9 o'clock. by Councilperson Coleman.
Second.
Seconded by Councilperson Waterman. Say goodnight, everyone.
Nine. 9 o'clock.
We're out of here.
No.
I win.
9 o'clock.
Price is right.
No, 9 o'clock.
It's over.
9 o'clock.
Who's got the key to that office?